Hello, everybody. This is your host, the one and only Mr. LP, Steven Sykes of Enliven Radio. We are part of LegacyInternetRadio.com. And this is one of the best, if not the best. In fact, I'm going to tell you the best information show in the world. How are you doing today? November 2nd, 2015. And as promised, when I host, I try to open up a show with a prayer. So please bear with me. Dear Lord, thank you very much for the opportunities and things that you have blessed us with and allowing me and other great people here to help share and express great and positive feelings and information and love and wealth and mercy and kindness and communication and everything we can. Please help those who are sick, injured, and those families who are struggling through financial difficulties, faith, love, and people who are just no longer with us, Lord. Please help us all and guide through your hands. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today, first of all, I want to let everybody know, trust me, don't worry, no, we did not tie up Miss Author TRACEYHARDNEY-SCOTT's RAWSILK. She is going to be with us and things and stuff like that. But today we got a great show. We're going to talk about a bunch of different things and positive stuff. And we're going to have a great guest call in about fatherhood and some other things. But I wanted to before we get going, I wanted to check in and say hello to you. And how are you doing today?
Good evening.
don't be shy now.
Good evening. This is Maya. How are you guys doing out there?
Yeah, I'm doing all right and things. I guess I should have introduced your name, but I like for people to let them introduce themselves and stuff like that. So you have to forgive me. So how are you doing today, Miss Maya?
I can't complain. It's been a long day, but it's a beautiful day outside and a gorgeous evening. Gorgeous evening.
Indeed, indeed. One of the few times we're going to have a nice warm weather. Pretty soon it's going to be messed up.
I don't look forward to that.
Amen.
I'm a summer baby.
Yeah, summer. I like them all. I think each season has its own special properties.
They do.
And things. But we're trying to keep on going. One of the things I wanted to ask you about, and later on today, I've got a good, I hate to say the word rant, but that I'm going to say, so listen out for that. But, you know, just some of the things that's happening in the news recently, and it's just sickening. Did you see the video of this young boy that was harassing a teacher?
You know what? Someone actually just sent it to me, but I didn't even watch it. What happened?
It's basically this young boy was harassing, and it's possibly maybe we don't know what type of class it was, but basically it was him and several kids basically harassing, yelling, throwing things at the teacher and doing all these different things. And it's just like, why? There's no need for all of this.
You know what? I don't know if I said this, but my first year as an educator, I had my nipple twisted. Mm-hmm. I had my butt groped. I was punched. I had a student smack my cell phone out my hand. And you just don't know what would provoke students to do that. And it's no excuse, but they do it. Even today, you know, the students, if a substitute is in the classroom, they'll pick up chairs and throw them. You really don't know. Some of them just do it to get out of class. Some of them, they just do it just to have something to do.
This guy was, this teacher's maybe a little bit tall, but a thin, small, older lady. And this guy, young boy, was usually about maybe 6'3", 6'4", something of that nature. And then telling her, sit down. And when she sat down, I told you you're going to sit down, you're going to bother. And it's just like, why are you doing this? There's no need for any of this.
Students, in light of what happened the other week with the young lady in South Carolina, mm-hmm. I think some students are revolting. Mm-hmm. They were revolting anyway, but I think they're using this as an excuse to revolt some more and to push. They push it to the limit. They really do push it. They push things to the limit. And they understand that not only will they get in trouble, but the teachers will get in trouble as well. But you actually just have some students who just do not care. Mm-hmm. Who just do not care. One student told me yesterday, she said to me, I just want to see how much I can do before I make you mad. That was her main goal, to see how mad that she could make me. And I said, well, you're not making me mad at all. But some students, they really just want to see how to push your buttons and how far they could go.
I think that I would personally be, I know this, if this was my child, I'd probably been in jail right about now, because I'd be danged if I let my child do anything of that nature to the person and stuff like that. As you can see probably in the video and things of that nature, but you know, I have the volume down, but they're smacking, they throwing M&Ms or smacking some type of candy at the guy and things, and she's asking for his name, and he's like, don't ask me my name, you have no nothing. And then there's his girl, as you can see, grabbing him to keep from beating up this teacher.
But do you remember the case that happened in Baltimore City last year,
mm-hmm.
where it was a substitute teacher,
right.
and the student was fighting the teacher, and the teacher fought the student back,
right.
and said, come on, let's go. A lot of the students believe, and they say, no matter what I do or no matter what I say to you, you can't do anything to me. And that's what they say.
And they feel that way because they feel that the rules are so jaded against them. Like, now, go ahead, call the police and things. I want you to.
The rules apply for administrators. You can curse the teachers out, the staff out, all you want. But when you have that principal or that assistant principal behind your name, in front of your name, then that's when you get disciplined. Now, what that young man did to that teacher was ridiculous.
And then there's two girls, a gentleman fighting with the girl, and it's just crazy. And it's just like, why are we, I really say that, and I'm trying to save it for later, but this is where mental health will be ignoring it for so long. Mm-hmm. It's in your DNA, it's in your system, and it's passed down, and now we're seeing the effects of everybody's being so careful of trying to pull back on the switch and not be heavy-handed. I'm not saying being heavy-handed, but still have a hand. And then now this is what happens because you let off of the gas.
This would not have happened. And I will say, I graduated in 1999.
Hello?
Hello? Give me one second. Hold your fart, please. Forgive me. Hello, sir. How are you doing today?
How are you?
I'm doing all right. Welcome to Enliven Radio, part of LegacyInternetRadio.com. How's everything going for you today?
Everything's wonderful.
All right. I appreciate it very much. Ms. Tracy is on her way. But I wanted to say, first off, thank you so very much for giving us a call and everything for today. And I know you're a busy man.
Yeah, somewhat today.
Not a problem. Do us a favor, if you don't mind. I like for people to introduce themselves and be proud of their name. Could you mind speaking your name, sir, in the title of your book?
Yes, my name is Mr. DeNovo Parks, and I'm the author of Sheltered and Sheltered Again.
Sheltered and Sheltered Again. That is a very powerful name and so forth, sir. Question, sir, where are you from, may I ask?
I'm from New York City.
Born and raised at what part?
Jamaica, Queens.
You're a Queens man. So you still there now?
I'm still there.
Hey, we appreciate it. Showing the hometown love. We won't tell everybody in New York that you're cheating on them right now. I understand. So we're not gonna talk.
Appreciate that.
We're not gonna talk about that and things. So you have sons. You're a single father currently.
Yes.
Okay. Let me ask you a question. As a man today, before we get into about your sons and things, as a father, what are you seeing today? With the issues with our young men being killed, attacked, terrorized, and things of that nature. And you see the anger and the angst, and we see our young men. We were just talking about, I don't know if you saw the video that just recently came out about the young man harassing the teacher, and then you see all these videos of guys fighting women and women fighting men. What is your thoughts on some of this, sir?
I believe, as far as our children are concerned, I think a lot of our children are missing. A lot of them are missing their fathers. They're missing the balance. They're coming from broken homes, and like I said, fathers not being there. Mothers might have been a drug addict, and they're missing guidance. They're missing. They're not learning their histories, the history of who they are and where they come from. And what I do and what I've done with my three sons, like I said, I'm a father of three boys. I raised them from babies. Is I taught them and teach them about who they are and where they come from. And I was fatherless, and I made sure that my sons were not going to be fatherless. And a lot of our children in these days, the number of people you just mentioned, I believe that they come from these situations where they don't have a strong family and a strong father to guide them and lead them. And that makes a difference in their psychology of who they are and what direction they're going in and what they're going to become. So they get caught up in life's unfortunate situations, which is negative, gangs, dealing with guns, violence, teenage pregnancy, and it leads to the things you just said, that what's happening in our community.
May I ask? Oh, go ahead, ma'am.
But my mother grew up in a single-parent home, and my grandmother not only raised two women, black women at that, she also adopted a son who his mother no longer wanted him and rather allow him to go into the system. A single black woman, my grandmother, with my auntie, raised three children and the children in the neighborhood. So I don't think it's necessarily the mother may be on crack or the father may not be there. I just think sometimes we have children and we have people who just go off in a different direction.
Absolutely.
They just go off. And then I know people who are in homes with a strong black mother and a strong black father, but that son still wants to take a separate path.
That's right. And you're going to have that no matter what you're doing. You're going to have that.
It depends on that.
It depends. I'm sorry.
It depends on your self-determination and what you want out of life.
Absolutely.
I could want all the success in the world for you, but if you don't want it, I can't make you have it. And sometimes you have to allow people to fall and hit rock bottom to realize, you know what mom was saying was right. What dad was saying was right. What grandmama was saying was right. What the village was saying to me was right, but I wanted to go left. You know, so.
And absolutely. And you're going to have, like you said, you're going to have kids who are going to come from a balanced household where you have the mother and the father, a nice home, a sister and a brother raised the same way. And mm-hmm. that other child is going to decide he's going to go in another direction.
Oh,
maybe because that's his personality.
And I would like to say thank you you for being a strong black man and a father to your sons and your children.
Thank you very much.
I would like to say thank you for that.
Thank you very much.
May I ask you a question, sir? How old are you currently?
I'm 52 years old.
Also, so you're still a young man. First off, thank
I'm
you.
I'm still a young man. That's right.
And I'm gonna call you out here on Radio Land. Make sure you get in your heart check your blood pressure, why what you eat, and get your prostate exam, sir.
And I've done all that.
Okay, keep going. Good. Now, as a young father,
as a father,
harken back to how you know you have children now. Correct me if I'm wrong. They're 8, 2, and 3, or sooner than that, or older, or how old are they now?
Oh, my sons right now they're 17. One just turned 20 a couple of days ago.
Okay,
and I have a 21-year-old.
Oh my! Woo!
And I raised them. I raised them from babies.
So and you're doing good. So in one way, we're gonna clap a hand that they're alive, and then at the same time,
amen, amen for that, amen.
Amen.
I worry about them every day. I give them advice on how they need to handle the streets, how they need to handle themselves in certain situations, respecting people, watching the type of friends you pick, and by all means, how to deal with the police.
Amen. Because not many people are doing that.
Right.
And growing up as a man in New York City, we see a lot of success, but unfortunately, a lot of that was always focused on some form of entertainment, either a sports or the music industry. And that they didn't see other things like success that was exposed to them, such as a business or political or some type of a job where you were making money, unless it was something dealing with entertainment or, unfortunately, the drug game. Do you feel growing up in at that time, was that a true statement to a point? And also, in addition, would it, being able to show more different types of success or diversity, would have helped more men of your age at the time who grew up follow this?
Yeah, are you talking about me or are you talking about my son?
Yeah, I'm talking about you.
I'm sorry, I didn't catch that last part. My phone went out a little bit.
Okay, I'm sorry. Basically, in New York City, as a father, and you spent a lot of your time growing up in the 70s and the 80s, there was, at the time, everybody was focused on when you see success, they thought you had to get involved in the drug game, or you was an athlete, or you were involved in entertainment. They didn't see other things as necessary, just getting an education, your career, and
also a business. Right.
If you do you feel that that was not exposed enough for you growing up as a young man and being...
I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, I'm saying that not being shown, would you think that having been able to show that, that would have helped so many men who are currently your age now who grew up fatherless?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I personally have been shown that. I had a caring mother who was very cultured, and she let me know what my capabilities were and what I can be. And a lot of kids are not showing that. A lot of kids don't grow up in a two-parent household. As you know, it's like a high 70-something percent where our kids are growing up with just the mother. And I had that as well. My father wasn't there. And my mother exposed me to let me know that, you know, hey, you don't have to be a drug dealer. You don't have to be a football player. You can be anything that you put your mind to. And I went after that. So a lot of our kids, no, they're not being taught properly, I believe. They're not being taught and told that, you know, you don't have to be just a rapper or a dancer or a football player. You could be president of the United States. You could go to the moon if you want to. And we're missing that. And I think a lot of that, like I said again, I blame a lot of our woes on fathers not being there. I blame a lot of that. My father, and I believe, and I'm an advocate for fatherhood, and an ambassador, if you want to call it. And I tell fathers, you know, that, you know, they need to be there for their kids, no matter how they feel about the mother, and let the child know what their capabilities are and what they're able to do. And if we have more fathers doing that, we'll have less teenage violence. We'll have less pregnancy. We'll have more kids running for more black kids running for president and trying to be a rocket scientist, if I can say. So a lot of our issues, I think, stem from fathers not being there. And that happens now, and it happened when I was younger.
You're correct, sir. And forgive me, I was incorrect before, sir. I'm one of the ladies is a businesswoman and who's a woman who works with children all the time, and a wonderful lady, Miss Maya Jones Lewis. I did not correctly introduce her name here to you, sir. So I do apologize about that.
That is okay. I would like to say that when children do grow up, male children, especially grow up in a single parent home with the mother. I don't like when mothers or parents, period, talk about the other parent negatively with the children, especially male children. And I've seen it happen before that certain parents have spoken about the father so negatively that the children develop these negative opinions about the father. And in turn, they don't understand not only will the males be angry towards their fathers, what I've seen, they're angry towards other male figures.
And that is true. In addition, they don't know how to they don't have that guidance to show how to deal with that anger from a male perspective, not demeaning any woman. And then at the same time, for the little girl, now you're treating that there's no trust in a man.
Yeah.
So do you begin to either have the woman become so angry and bitter, or B, looking for hurt, that anytime some guy shows some type of affection, she's willing to draw her pants down, thinking that that's how to keep a man.
Oh, verbal abuse means love. Physical abuse means love, and it doesn't. So and I'm speaking, I'm not a parent. I don't have any children, but I have friends who have children, and I'm a teacher as well. So I see a lot of single parents. I work with a lot of single parents. And one thing that I do not agree with, even when we're having meetings, I don't agree with when the mother is talking negatively about the father, or the father is speaking negatively about the mother in front of strangers. So I can just imagine what they're saying at home. So I think, you know, this is just for everyone who's listening. If you are a single parent, and I know the struggle is real, and I know it's hard, sometimes you have to keep those thoughts to yourself and those negative comments to yourself, because when children get older, they know. They figure it out. They know. But you're also teaching your child a way to disrespect the other parent, and we don't want that to happen. We want to end these cycles.
What would you say? I'm sorry. Go ahead, sir. I was asking you, what would you say about that?
No, I agree with everything she says. It's, you know, it's very difficult raising children by yourself. And when you're raising them as babies, and you have multiple children, you have to cope with a lot of pressure, a lot of picking up the kids, a lot of dropping the kids off, a financial pressure as well. And when you don't have that second party who helped you bring these children into this world, abandoning their posts and going where they want to go and having fun, or you know, just moving to another state or whatever, that makes it difficult for that individual who's taking care of the children. And a lot of times they may speak badly about the parent that's not there. And you're absolutely right. It's wrong. And you know what? I'm going to be honest with the audience. I fall into that category because I was raising my three boys as babies, and I couldn't understand why the mother wasn't part of their lives. And as they got older, I would be saying, you know, negative things about the mother, because, you know, here I am, the father. I'm taking up my responsibilities. You're the mother. They came out of you. Anybody should be raising these kids, it's you. But she decided that, you know, she wasn't capable of doing it by herself, or not at all. So I would say negative things about the mother out of frustration, not anything to try to really hurt the mother. It's out of frustration of what you're going through, and you're holding the bag of taking care of all these children, especially if you have multiple children, because the more you have, the worse it is. And here is the second party just running off into the sunset and abandoning their post of being a parent to children you're both brought into this world. So, absolutely. As my kids got older, see, I made sure that I never lied to my kids. So that's the difference for me. I always made sure I told the truth, because I knew, number one, I had boys, and I didn't want that to backfire on me. So I knew that sooner or later, you know, that my boys were going to get older and they was going to see the truth. So when I did, you know, say my little nasty things about the mother because she refused to help me. She refused to be financially. She refused to be there for certain periods of their time in their lives. That was important. I would say that, well, maybe your mother with her boyfriend or something of that nature, I would say. And it was wrong. It was wrong. And I'm telling the audience, it's wrong. It's not cool to do. My mother jumped all over me about it. And, you know, I always try to follow advice of a woman because, you know, they're right often. Not all the time, but they're right often. So I made sure that I listened to what my mother said. I try to keep my comments to myself. Try to let my kids see how their mother's going to be as they got older, and you know things would fall into their place.
Right.
And amen. I want to let you know that you know, sir, and everybody else know that Tracy is in the
Silk
building.
Is in the building.
I'm playing her theme song, very quick. I have to play her theme song real quick.
I need a theme song. I like that.
I like it, boy.
You know, Mr. LP, you got me nodding my head over here. You honor me. Yes.
I extended the ending a little bit.
I appreciate the ending. Your girl, RAWSILK, is definitely in the building. And
hello.
Hi, DeNova. How are you? And I thank you so much for joining us this evening. Thank you, Mr. LP, thank you, Myra, for untying him and letting him speak. Girl, that traffic is a mess. DeNova, you can relate because we come from a city that traffic is off the chain. So let me just say I was in some New York City type of traffic a few minutes ago. So you already know how that is. But I'm just going to jump right in. I want to pick up where you left off because you said three key things that I wanted to chime in before we start actually talking about your book. And one of the things that I wanted to say to you, I'm so glad that you were bluntly honest a few minutes ago about saying, you know, negative or derogatory things, because what happened is what I like to call the boomerang effect. You as a man went through what the average single mother goes through
every day.
Okay. And that was one of the things that impressed upon me, because, and I'm glad you stayed there, because that's the perfect thing for us to pick up for when you want to talk about, Myra, unjustifiable reasons that men and women utilize not to be around their children. So we're definitely going to talk about that. But one thing that you said that I want you to expand on before I bite your head off is when you said those babies came out of you. You should want to take care, if anybody should want to take care of them. I think that's a misconception that everybody thinks that just because someone lays down and can fertilize or have an egg that makes them a mother. Not everyone is born with maternal instincts, and you have some fathers
Absolutely.
That have better maternal instincts. And I think the reason why I wanted to say that, and you'll see when we get deeper into our conversation, is just like for yourself, the battle that you fought to fight to get your boys, the court systems and the social workers and all of them, they seem to have this misconception always that the mother will make a better parent than the father. And that is not always the case.
No, it's not always the case, but it's the case. And most of the time, that's why the courts want the mother to have the children over anybody else, because the kids come out of the mother, and they're the perfect candidate to raise those children. So, I mean, in every case, absolutely, that's not every mother had the naturalness of raising children and standing up and taking on her responsibilities.
Because
I totally agree with you.
Yeah, I do, because that's what people see. They see, oh, she's the mother. That conception, right. Oh, she carried the baby for 9 months. She's going to love it. She's going to breastfeed it. She's going to care for it. She's going to pick him or her up and hold him. But you have to understand, I've seen some mothers, I would never, and I said I would never say never. I would never speak to my baby some way. I saw this one woman in Burlington one day. The baby was maybe about 18 months, just learning to walk. The woman called the baby every type of MF and B in the book. And everyone stopped in the store
and looked.
And looked at her. And one lady said, ma'am, she's a baby. She could miss the cursing everyone out, but we understood. And I've never had any children. She's a baby. You don't treat the baby like that. But I think what we need to see more of, people need to publicize our black men with their children. Because you see it. And whenever I see it, I think it's the most beautiful vision that I've ever seen.
And I'm glad that you said that. It is the beautiful vision. And that was one of the reasons and the opportunity that I was able to meet DeNorval in the first place. We met at the Million Man March. Okay. And he was there with his sons. And I thought that that was powerful, mm-hmm. that he pressed on with his sons. And then, you know, we were talking, he was cross-marketing his book. But the fact that he didn't consider it robbery to be there with his sons, mm-hmm. okay, those are the things, you're right, that should be publicized. I think especially coming from someone, just to give you guys a little bit of history, my grandmother was a foster mother. She raised 26 foster children. We don't call them steps because we have a bunch of uncles and aunts, so to speak. Mm-hmm. But one of the things I remember is one of my uncles was an abused child, and he was removed from his home. And the history is that he was removed from the home strictly because he looked like his father. Mm-hmm. And the mother was so hateful, the hate that she had for mm-hmm. the father, she took out on him in burning him with cigarettes. Okay? And the crazy thing is this kid had, and up until this day, still has an undying love for his mother. And I say that to say that we, again, and I think, DeNorval, you've worked diligently and you can speak about that when we talk about your group. But one of the things that we have to do is we have to re-educate the systems. You're right. It is automatically assumed that the mother is the custodial parent, okay, because she birthed the kid. But father had a sperm donation in there. Where's some rights? You know, I know one of the arguments that I had is when I relocated here from New York City, I had to get my son's father's permission that he was down here in order to register him for school. Yeah. They didn't just automatically assume that because he was with me that he had those. But I want to talk about unjustifiable reasons that is used to keep children away from their father. Let's talk about that out of sight, out of mind. Okay? And we find that women in general, I'm not just going to say black women, but women in general, they see it as a form of rejection when you walk away. And we talked about this, Myra, before. You guys didn't make it. You all broke up. He broke up with you. He didn't break up with that child. How do you bridge that gap, DeNorval?
Well, you mean as far as the mother coming together with the father, or
both? Either way,
responsibility.
Right. Either way,
responsibility part.
Mm-hmm. Responsibility wise, because one of the things that we talked, Mr. LP and I, we had a show once before, and a guest was on, and they were like really shocked when they were like, "With child support," and I was like, I didn't go to court for child support for my son's father because it was clear from at birth that half is yours. So anything that he got, half is yours. I don't need to go to a judge, and I daggone sure don't need to sit in the system for you to tell me what my child needs and doesn't need. You know the same things that you fundamentally need.
I know some women who have gotten mad because the child's father has moved on. And because the child's father's in a new relationship and is happy to ruin your happiness, I'm going to go to court and I'm going to make you pay child support because...
Right.
Not because I need
not
it.
Not because I need it or want it. Or it's want a revenge it. Mechanism.
And then what a lot of people don't know is that even though that whole time I wasn't in a relationship and I still came over to see you every once in a while and I still was taking care of my child... financially, emotionally, physically, when you go to court, the court system says, well, that wasn't child support. That's a gift. Was a gift.
And that's because we have not changed the systems. We have not changed the systems. Mm-hmm. And we're going to talk about that in great detail because I definitely want to talk about that the second half of the show. But I definitely want to move back a little bit. And I know that you guys
are... Can I answer your question?
Sure, go ahead.
Sorry.
Yes. I stopped. I apologize. But to answer that question, to bridge that gap, you really can't bridge that gap. Because if one parent decides that they're not going to be a participant in raising the children that they both brought into this world, there is nothing you can do about it. That's the reason why the parent who was raising the children or the child takes the other parent to court, because they're not standing up to their bargain, or they are part of the responsibility of raising a child. So if it was like in my case, if it was the mother who decided that she didn't want, there's nothing I can do. You could talk to the person until they're blue in the face. If they don't want to share responsibility and be responsible for taking care of their blood, which kills me, then there's nothing you could do about it. The only thing that that parent could do is just go to court and do the financial thing. But as far as morally, the father or the mother who's absent, taking the child down to the park, walking with them, being a participant, as far as coming to their graduation, and things of that nature that a child needs to see the parents participating in as they're growing up so they can feel whole, you can't make the other parent do anything. The courts can't even make them do it. That's
and,
why the
and
courts.
And I agree. And that's why I said money. We really need to have some form of reform, because realistically, okay, statistically, there are more African American single parent households across the board. So we already know that this is just another system to disenfranchise us and already attack our children. Okay,
absolutely.
So we definitely have to start looking at these things, because I find it hard to believe that no one can hold parents account. We hold people accountable for some of the craziest things. Okay, we hold people accountable in the United States of America if they don't take care of their dog, if they don't take care of their animals correctly. But when it comes down to children, there's no accountability. Then that, you know, this is the perfect thing to talk about when we are right here now in the height of election time, and we are listening to half of these idiots that are running for the president of the United States. Okay, we need to be paying attention. These are the questions, and you know, DeNovo, when we were talking at the Million Man March, these are the things that people should be looking at when they're looking for who is going to be the next leader of this country. What are you going to bring to the table to bring about change? And our children are under attack. My sister's here. We had a show a week ago, and one of the things that we talked about is we talked about this whole cradle to prison mentality. Okay, and we're clear that when it comes down to the African American household, it is deliberately has systems in place to disenfranchise us, to make it where the man can't be at home. And now we have a lot of sisters in the penal system to be at home. So somewhere along the line, we've got to come up with positive solutions. Otherwise, we're going to run into these problems again and again.
I think that the next leader of America is not going to help lead the black community.
I
think the black community, we need to function and lead ourselves.
Because, amen. That's my point.
Anything that they do is not going to be in the best interest of us. They'll need our vote so they'll win. They'll need our money so they can live. But at the end of the day, they don't care about the black family.
They don't
family.
Give two craps about
until
us.
Until the black family.
Just give me your vote. Absolutely.
Yeah, until the black family.
And so my point is, don't give them your vote.
We need to put the votes within our community.
Exactly.
We need to have our own leaders. And we have to understand, sometimes when you step out there and you do become a leader, we all have skeletons in our closet. We all have certain things that we are embarrassed of. But if we want to be leaders, we have to step up and say, hey, that's my past. That's what I used to be. It helped me become who I am. But we need to start leading each other and stop thinking that America is going to help us.
Right.
All we do is help America keep it moving.
And man, let me update some information, please, not to offer correction
sure.
towards you, man. It's factually, yes, and factually, when you say it in terms of leading as single parents. We have, in terms of our percentage of our of our race, black race overall, is 75%, but not in terms of number. This is one thing me and Marcus try to correct, like when they always say we're, in some ways we're leading, but within our race, but we're not, when they want to say it's always black single mothers or it's always the majority of white, we're not overall in terms of numbers, we're not the leading by far.
I don't believe that.
And I'll give you an example. For example,
leading in what?
Okay, well, for example, when we say single parents and things, black is almost, there's over 6.4 million black single mothers who are raising children. Hispanic is 7 million, but a white is 9.2 million. Now, the thing is, because there's so many more of them, it's only 25%. But because it's, we're not, because there's like, what, 50, almost 60% of them. So obviously that's only 25%. Whereas for us, there's only like 12% of America is black. So obviously when we have darn near almost 6.4 million, that's 75%. So that's where that comes in. When it comes to, let's say, receiving food stamps and benefits, it's way more of them by number.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
And everything else. That. It's just that by percentage, it's small compared to us. That's what I wanted to offer.
You have to look when these U.S. departments, the Bureau of Labor Statistics.
Yeah, I'm looking at it.
I was reading some information a couple of weeks ago. The sample size, now they said, 39 million? Americans or African Americans?
It's about 51 million.
But they were using the 2010, 2011, and 2012.
I thought it was census. It was 45.
But they did a census. They used the census for those 3 years, and they did the report in November of 2014.
But you can't. But you're like right now we're in the 2015. You can't get in. And to be honest, because it's so much data, you can't get all the 2014 census by now.
Exactly.
The closest accurate right now is 2013.
And so what they did, it was published in November by an economist in November 2014. But the sample size that they only used was 11,000 black households. Mm-hmm, so how is that an accurate sample size to do on a pre-tax income? They only used a sample size of 11,000 households. And the age group that they used was the age group of 47.
The median age was 47.
But that's such a small sample size to use to give an accurate account of a whole entire population.
And that's why, exactly, and expanding on what Myra said, that's why I don't believe those Google statistics. The statistics that I believe is as being a single parent and having a group of single parents as friends and sitting with two school teachers who deal with single parents on a daily basis. The one thing that I am really, really clear is that when you go to school, there are more Caucasian family households. And when I say single parent, I'm not talking about just a mom being on her. I'm talking about, okay, because I have Caucasian friends that are not together.
But they
are co-raising their children.
That's what
when I'm talking about single parent, I'm talking about a child that is accountable to one parent.
I'm agreeing. I'm not disagreeing with that. When I gave that information, I'm saying it in support of you. That's what I'm saying is almost is 75%. I believe it's more than 75%. The only advantage that I would say that with the sample size is not correct, but is correct in showing that there is a doggone need and is a problem that we're not getting the funds and the education, the money to our communities. They're not giving us the votes. They're not fixing our roads. When you see in that sample size how drastically is bad in that sample size compared to somebody else's.
What's the income? The question is, good question.
Good point.
What's the income of the single mothers in the Caucasian or white community? What's the household income?
Oh, gosh, that's a drastic difference. I've seen it. It's a drastic difference.
But just thinking, I know a single mother. She's a single mother. Her ex-husband is a neurosurgeon.
Right.
He's a neurosurgeon. She's a doctor as well.
Okay.
She met him during her residency. She's a neurosurgeon. And back to when you said, RAWSILK, when you said that you had to speak with your son's father, she is not allowed to, I'm not going to say the state, she's not allowed to leave out the state with her son at all until he turns 18. But she's a single parent. He's a neurosurgeon. And she's a doctor. She's
It goes back in Novell. You correct me if I'm wrong, but, you know, we have this terminology we use in New York a lot, money talk, bullshit walks.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, mm-hmm. Let's tell the truth and shame the devil. And that's exactly what it is because, okay, demographically, the problem that I have with census is that the average poor person doesn't participate in census.
No.
The reason why I know that they are bogus numbers because Hispanic communities do not trust governmental officials. Their fear of deportation allows them to avoid, so they're not filling out any census forms or anything of that nature because they don't want to be tracked, number one. So I know the Hispanic numbers are bogus, number one. Number two, most people who are poor, disenfranchised, and living in the hood, so to speak, we don't have time to be filling out censuses and mailing back. That's something that gets put on the side with the junk mail. And don't knock on my door asking me absolutely anything.
Yeah.
So again, when we start Googling things or whatever, I'm saying you have to be out there, like Darnell Crothers says, in the urban Serengeti and dealing in the jungle 100%. You could Google anything that you want to Google. I just don't believe those numbers are factual. I think the other problem that I have is that, okay, and one of the reasons why I really wanted to do this show and talk to DeNorville and get his input, but also we're going to go into his book. But one of the things that we have is that we have a wealth of fathers, African-American fathers, who are out there raising their children, raising them well in a single-parent household, and we're not talking about them. We're not applauding them. I know a man that used to work for me, okay, that was raising his two daughters. He wasn't raising sons, and he was braiding hair and doing pigtails and going to cheerleading and everything else. And all of the women at the Little League wanted to embrace and help out. And he was like, I'm fine. I got this. Okay, you see what I'm saying? Whereas if a woman registered her two children, she's solid. She's doing her thing. That woman is on her grind. But we automatically assume that a man needs some form of assistance in order to raise his children. And I think that we have got to stop doing that.
Or what they have done, not just the single black father who's raising his children, but what they have started publicizing, glamorizing, and saying this is so wonderful. The article I read with the two men were married raising the daughters.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, well, I know single black heterosexual males who've been doing the same thing
forever. So we feed into all of these stereotypes,
mm-hmm.
and then we run into a de novo or Damon, the guy that I was telling about. We don't just applaud them for answering the call, stepping up, and doing what they were supposed to do. The expectation is always that the woman is supposed to do what she's supposed to do because she's the mother, but the man gets a get-out-of-jail-free card.
And what I would say, like I said, I'm not a parent. Can't wait. People tell me, Maya, yes, you can.
Wait.
They say wait.
No, take your time, girl.
They say take your time.
Tell her.
But I'm 34. What I will say, mother and father, they need each other.
They do.
Yes.
At the end of the day, I know my parents had three children. I was the baby girl. One day, my dad sat me down, and he looked at me. He said, Maya, he said, you know, I was nine. He said, whooping you just is not working. Yeah. It's not working. He said, I give up. He said, whatever you do, as long as you don't disrespect me and your mother, I give up. That scared me more than anything because I never would want my father. He didn't mean that, of course, but, you know, my mom had to tag team him in. Like, Lonnie, I've been here with this child. I don't know what she's been doing all day long. Mothers and fathers, they need each other to raise children because it's a full-time job.
And children are not weapons of mass destruction.
No.
Meaning that you cannot utilize your child as a weapon to get even with the other person, okay, and make up excuses. We don't seem to realize, and when I say we, because I am a part of that single mother sorority that has done that. It's a curse that we do because we see it over and over. One of the things that I've always credit my mother with is my mother never talked bad about my father, no matter what. And my mother always said, I don't care if this is your father. If you see him in the street and he's bleeding, you're behind, better go over and give him a Band-Aid. My issue with your father is not your issue with your father.
And that's what we discussed earlier. You never, and what I don't like, to hear parents say, oh, you just like your no-count daddy. Oh, you just like your lying mama. Why are you going to embed that into that child's mind?
Because they become verbal weapons, and we're going to talk about that in great detail. So, with that being said, now that I've been fashionably late and done got comfortable with the conversation, let's talk about Mr. DeNovell Parks.
Okay. Talk about me.
Yeah, we want to talk about you. And I know that you're a native New Yorker. And I know that you took on the challenge of raising your three sons. Okay. And I know that we met at the Million Man March. And for those of you that are present that didn't know, he is an author. He has two books called Sheltered, and the other one is Sheltered Again. And both of them are true accounts of his life story. So with that said, before we jump into your life story, tell us about you, Mr. Parks.
Well, I was raised by a single mother. My father was there in the beginning up until 10. After that, I don't know what happened to him. I have
he didn't
a brother,
go off for a pack
a
of brother, cigarettes
an older
and
sister.
Didn't come back.
I went to college. I went to Queen Bell College. Okay. I started college, never completed college. I never completed college because I got custody of my three beautiful boys who I love so much.
Okay.
From there, I went into the shelter system. I went to the shelter system in 1998. I received my boys in 1998. I moved in with my mother and my grandmother and other relatives for about almost a year, I would say like 9 months.
Okay.
There, my mother and my grandmother, which, you know, I like to equate it with Star Wars. You know, I'm Luke Skywalker, and I'm being taught by professionals and masters. So my mother and my grandmother taught me how to change a bottle. They taught me how to do the pamper thing. They taught me how to tell the temperature. You know, men don't have these natural traits to do these things. We need to be taught that. Women have it. It's natural. That's why the courts automatically will give them to the mother, and it's hard to get them from the mother because y'all have the natural ability to do these things. So from there, I went to the shelter. I stayed into the shelter for 2.5 years. At times, I would cry like a little baby because I was like, oh, my God, I'm taking care of my kids. I'm trying to go to school at the same. I was doing all this simultaneously. I'm trying to, you know, continue to go to school, finish school, working a full-time job, and it was overwhelming for me. And I'm sorry.
Oh, no. And I want to get into that overwhelming part. I know when you and I talk, we were saying that, you know, when I read some of your bio and some of the book, that your story is similar to like Christopher Gardner's story. And those of that that's listening, that's not
right,
familiar.
Right.
Christopher Gardner's story is the story that Will Smith covered in the movie Pursuit of Happiness.
Right.
And one of the things that I said, well, let's digress a minute. So we know that you took custody of your boys. Tell me, first of all, how was that? How was that transition? And what I mean by the transition, how was, like, dealing with the legal system of trying to be a single dad, getting custody of your boys? Did you find that easy and supportive? Did you run into brick walls? How was that?
It was difficult because I, you know, after a while, I was getting so frustrated with the mother of not being there that to help me raise these wonderful children. I decided I was going to take her to court. I didn't want to take her to court. But, you know, men are not quick to run to court to do these things. So I didn't really want to take her to court. So after getting frustrated for so many years, I decided to do that. And unfortunately, she wasn't working. So they, you know, she was on welfare, and she wasn't getting a lot of that. So they, you know, they gave her a way out. They was like, all right, being that you're not working and, you know, there's only so much, they're telling me, there's only so much that we could do, Mr. Parks, as far as the mother's concerned, because she's not working. We can't take money from her. We can't make her physically take her down there to help take care of these children. So the mother got over as far as that concerned, and they decided to put her in jail. which I was, you know, I didn't want her to go to jail, but I did want her to help me raise children and help and engage in their upbringing and some kind of financial input, because, you know, I had to do everything myself, pay the rent and, you know, feed the kids, buy their clothes. It was really rough for me.
And so, what were the ages of the boys at that time?
I'm sorry, what'd you say?
What were the ages of the boys at that time?
Oh, at that time, the ages of the boys, I got my son, my baby, Ahmad, was about 6 months. My son, Akeem, he was about 2 years old. He just turned two. And my son, Elijah, he was 3 years old.
So you basically had infants. You had babies. Babies.
I had babies.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, so well, I had a baby, and the other two were considered to be toddlers, but they're still considered to be babies.
Right.
And like I said, they were, all three of them were still in Pampers. A lot of times, boys.
They take longer. Trust me, I know. Uh-huh. They take longer to break.
Right. They would come out of Pampers a little earlier. My boys took, for some reason, all three of them took over three to come out of their Pampers.
Okay.
So, you know, the Pamper thing is a killer. When you have a baby or a child, you're going to learn. Just re up on them Pampers, girl, because that some Pampers are killing.
I understand.
You're making me nervous now. You're making me nervous.
We have another guest here, and I'm going to let her introduce herself. I know she has a question or comment to add towards this.
Miss Ashley.
Yes, you do. Come on in here. Go on up in here. First of all, thank everybody on Periscope for supporting us.
And
But come on up to the mic and speak your piece.
I actually don't really have anything to say.
She just enjoying the call.
Enjoying the show.
But like having our sister
here. I'm glad to be here and hearing the story of Mr. Paul.
Not a problem. But you know, you're a school teacher. How is this relating to what he's saying towards the children that you work with?
See, now to be honest, I came in the middle of the conversation, so I'm not really sure.
So give her a chance. Well, we're talking about Mr. Parks is a single dad who raised three children, and we're going to pick up from there, and then we're going to allow her to chime in. Mr. Parks, so now you have custody of your children. You go home to the family dynamics of a supportive mom and your grandmother, and they're teaching you basically parenting 101. Okay, and everything is fine. And then what happens that you end up living in a shelter with your
boys? In a shelter, what happened was the house that they were living in was sold.
Okay.
So I was forced to go into the shelter system. Around that particular time, we had the heads up that the house was going to be sold. So I decided, I lived in Flushing, Queens at the time, which is the most diverse city in the world. So what happened was I started looking for apartments, and it was like predominantly Hispanic and Chinese around that time. And nobody, I felt, and I think, I have grounds to think that there was the landlords, the owners, the supers didn't want a black man raising three babies, extra Hispanics or Chinese at that time. So I never found an apartment.
Okay.
So I had to go straight into the shelter. I was looking for months for an apartment. Sometimes I would go find an empty apartment, and I'll ask the landlord or super or whoever was in charge about the apartment that was empty, and they would tell me that it was taken. I would come back maybe a month or so later, and the apartment was still empty. So that made me believe that they didn't really want me there.
And just to let me interrupt you just for a minute and paint a picture, because I want everybody to be clear. Just in New York City doesn't stress a lot of the fair housing laws that they do down here in Virginia, whereas like Molly and them is on it. New York City is one of those places that, hey, the landlord basically does whatever the landlord does. So there's not a whole lot of recourse. I mean, they have agencies out there, but it's so much red tape and bureaucracy. You be done found an apartment before you get fair housing. So you do have people that vastly out there, especially out in the area that he's talking about in Flushing and Queens, that have very nice houses and reasonable at that time, but they have the option to rent to single parents,
whoever they want.
They will actually put in their ads no children or things of that nature, and there's no one to send up a red flag and say, hey, this apartment is vacant, this person needs a house. If they qualify, you need to rent to them. It's rare in New York City, unless you go to a realtor, that you fill out an application for an apartment. It's basically you go talk to the landlord, I like you, I rent you my place.
Can I just ask, I hope I'm not jumping in.
No.
I just want to ask a question. Has the mother ever said that she was sorry or apologized?
Never.
Never.
She's in denial about it.
Okay. Ashley asked the question, how long was she incarcerated for?
No, she wasn't incarcerated.
Oh, she wasn't. Okay.
No,
let me ask you a question since we open that before we move on. Okay, so, and she's never, like you said, apologized or anything else.
Never.
Has she moved on? Does she have other children?
No, she don't have other children.
Okay, was she older?
She has my two oldest sons right now.
Okay.
Because they both graduated. They both gone to college right now.
And they're gone back to
what happened was she became ill. She had heart problems, and she had an operation. So I told my oldest sons that y'all have to go over there and go take care of your mother. You know, even though, you know, I have disagreements with her, you know, that's your mother. As you were saying before, that, you know, you talking about a young lady respecting her father regardless of the situation. If he bleeds, give him a bandage. You know, I was telling them that whatever the situation is with me and your mother, that's between me and your mother. All right, that's your mother. Y'all go over there, and you know, they didn't. You know, they didn't feel negative toward her. They just couldn't understand why she wasn't there the way she was supposed to be. But there was still that love. All right, so I told them that they had to go over there, and you have to take care of your mother. That's your job. Because I try to teach my boys responsibility and to do their job. This is your job as a man. This is your job. You take care of your family. You bring home the money and the bacon, and you know you fix the pipe under the sink. That's your job as a man. So I told them they had to go stay with their mother and help take care of her, which they're doing presently right now, and they're doing a good job.
And they will be blessed because the scripture said, honor thy mother and father, so your days shall be longer.
Right.
So they don't have to answer for what she did.
She did, right.
She has to answer for that, and they are honoring
her. That's right.
They are honoring you,
that's
your wishes, and they're honoring her. And see, through, she may never say it, but for her to be sick and her children are there for her
after you walked away, that's huge.
And that's the grace of God, that they don't show any malice towards her. They're still honoring her, and they're honoring you. You did a wonderful job with them.
Thank you very much, ladies.
But
I noticed that a lot of times when the other parent is not there and the children grow up, whether it's the father or the mother, whether or not they've been talking bad about the father and the mother, the children still have that bond. They still want that bond with their mother, even when they're up in age. You know what I mean? It depends on the severity of it. Some kids just don't want nothing to do with their parents. But a lot of times you'll feel kids still attracted to their mother and father because they need that love. Mm-hmm. They need it. And they still accept the parent into their lives. And that's what my boys did. The parent who wasn't there had limited say to them because the child would always throw in their face, well, you wasn't there for me the way you're supposed to be. Even though they loved them, they limit them in as far as listening to what that parent has to say because that parent wasn't there totally. Right. So even though I love you and I'm here for you, but you know what? You can't tell me I can't do this and I can't do that
because you wasn't there for me.
But that's what happens a lot in the broken household.
Well, one of the things that, and I want to expand on that before we move on, is because when you talk about generational curses, and one of the things that you said, and I definitely want to address because I want to dispel this myth to everyone that's listening to the sound of my voice. Just because you lay on your back and birth a child does not make you a mother. and nope. does not mean that you have maternal instincts. And behaviors are manifestations of things that have been poured into people. I guarantee you, if you look at her dynamics with her mother or her grandmother and how they are, this is why she didn't have enough poured into her or what it took to be a mother. Either that or she didn't want children in the first place, but she kept having them. This is not just by happenstance. You just don't wake up and say three children in that I can't do this. I just can't do this.
No, her mother and her father were there. She came from one of those strong households
okay.
in Long Island. She had the mother, she had the father. They both had good jobs, and, you know, they were there for them. It's
okay.
just that, you know, everybody's different. You know what I mean? Every mother's not, because they are capable of birthing a child, may not be there for them. You know what mm-hmm. I mean? So she, you know, she did come from a strong household. It's just that she decided, you know, she always wanted to you know, have that picket fence. You know, she wanted what her mother and father had.
Okay.
And
she
I wanted that as well. But things didn't go in that direction, which I'm not going to get too far into. And I decided that, you know, I'm not going to marry somebody who, you know, had certain problems and is, you know, is going to make my head be spinning around.
Okay. Did you all talk?
So when the children were born, it's really deep. But, you know, we had the first child, you know, things didn't work out. And, you know, we continued to do, you know, the nasty and all that. And and we had the second child, and we had the third child. And she always wanted to have that father there, which was me, help raise the kids, you know, bring home, you know, the bacon and things of that nature. But when I left, it's like her world fell apart. Things weren't going the way she wanted to go. You know, she didn't see us getting married anymore. She didn't see that house that, you know, she thought that we could live in as a family. And, I guess she wanted all that with the kids. And if I can't get all that with the kids, then you know what? I'm not just going to be the type of parent that I'm supposed to be. That's what I'm assuming what happened.
Right, and it sounds more like not parenting. It sounds that somebody who lived in their own bubble. It's not for me to judge her,
right.
but it sounds
right.
like someone who lived in their own bubble had a sense of selfishness, okay, and a false reality, and women do that all the time. One of the things that I talk about in my books is that we start planning the wedding at hello, okay? So there's a broken language between what men say and do and what women hear, okay? And so that's where it is. And so then when that gets shattered, sometimes they just can't recuperate and get, you know what I'm mm-hmm. saying, get themselves back. But now we want to talk about, okay, so you have the babies, you got custody of them, and now you're forced to...
And I went into the shelter. I went back into the shelter.
Okay.
And I was there for, like I said, I was going to college at the time, and I was working. I had all that. You would have looked at me, you would have never thought that I was in the shelter.
Right, and that was the amazing thing, because I seen an article that they actually did on you from your union, and they were, like, floored because you were working...
On my website.
You were working. You didn't fit the whole status quo of what someone who was literally homeless, what they thought. It shocked a lot of people. One of the things that I wanted to share when we start talking about that shelter life is that for our listeners, they should know that New York City is one major city. They have mandated emergency shelter. So what that means is, whereas like in other states, like in the Pursuit of Happiness, mm-hmm. you got to get to the shelter early, sign your name on the mm-hmm. thing, and if you're lucky, New York, they have to
take
you in.
Right.
You get a bed irregardless somewhere in one of their crisis houses. But let me paint the picture, and then I'm going to come back to you, DeNovo, okay? There's an article that came out in the New York Times in March of this year, and they covered an investigation into the New York City shelter system. And the article says, a New York City homeless shelter system that is supposed to provide a refuge for family and children instead forces them to live in the most squalid of conditions that includes dead rats in apartments, garbage thrown in the hallways and stairways, puddles of urines in elevators and stairwells. These findings were amongst hundreds of health and safety violations in a 54-page document revealed on Thursday by Mayor Bill de Blasio. The Homeless Service Department, which houses 11,900 families, currently operates 145 shelters. Now, let's do that number again. 11,900 families are living in only 145 shelters and 16 temporary housing. The DOI has cited dangerous living conditions, rat and roach infested residents, fire violations, health and safety measures, building code violations, obstructions, lock exits, missing windows, non-working smoke and carbon monoxide detectors, persistent infestations of bed bugs and rodents, poor maintenance, fire safety problems, broken fixtures, broken toilets, and other things that make living inhabitable. Tell us, what was your experience in the New York City shelter system?
Well, I lived in a number of shelters.
Okay.
So that's why I'm qualified to write the books.
Okay.
That I wrote.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't experience that.
Okay,
I experienced, the shelters that I went to were decent. They
great.
Were decent. And you have
okay.
different tiers. You have a tier one and a tier two.
Mm-hmm.
A tier one, you come in and, you stay there for a couple of months. They investigate. The questionnaire that you gave them, they go to your house and all that, see if there's, where you lived at last for the last 2 years, and then you go to the tier two.
Mm-hmm.
I lived in a Brooklyn shelter that was close to what you were saying. When soon as I came in, there were weeds.
You must have been talking about Atlantic Avenue.
Huh?
Was you talking about Atlantic Avenue?
No,
castle.
Yes. Going down Atlantic Avenue.
Yeah,
right?
No, I know.
It's a little bit off,
mm-hmm.
but it's going down that way. So, what do you mean? You talk about the men's shelter on Atlantic?
Right.
No, I wasn't
do they
there.
Take? Yeah, because they don't take families.
Shelter.
Okay.
No, that's an all man shelter. I
got
was
you.
In a family shelter,
and that's what I was going to ask you. Do you think that your experience was what it was strictly because you were dealing more family instead of men? Because
oh,
I know
yes.
that the
oh,
men's
yeah,
shelters are deplorable.
Oh yeah,
okay.
A family shelter and a single individual shelter is a lot different. But when I was when I got to this particular shelter, I noticed that the weeds were high. There were rats inside the weeds. I got to there, the windows, the screens in the windows were all ripped. Which prevents the mosquitoes from coming in. I noticed that they were ripped up. The halls need to be swept. It was bad, but it wasn't on a level that you were saying. I didn't
mm-hmm.
find dead, rats inside my household. But there were mice. They
and
had a lot of
right.
mice.
New
they
York
had a lot of they,
mm-hmm. not just there.
They had a lot of roaches. So it was, it could have been worse, but when I got there, I got lucky because they started cleaning all that up. They cut the weeds, so now there was no more rats. They started, cleaning up the halls more. I just came at the right time, but I did get to see what some individuals who have families go through in some of these shelters. So not all shelters are the same.
Right.
All shelters are not the same. All of them don't look alike. You might have a shelter that might look like an
apartment
building,
or
but
house,
it's a shelter.
Right.
It depends on the shelter. Like, every state is different. Every shelter is different.
Got you.
Because they run by an individual who care or might not care.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So every shelter is different. You can't say every shelter is the same because it's in New York. They all are different. So I came across some great shelters I lived in. I mean, they had green grass. The staff was fair. That was my first shelter I went into. The apartments were painted. The staff did their job. The security did their job. They kept, the people there had to respect each other, meaning the residents. And some shelters, you go to another shelter, you'll have none of that. It might be chaotic. Everybody's fighting each other. The staff will probably be up in some other woman's apartment, you know, having sex with them. So it's, every shelter was different.
Was there like time frames, like for these shelters? Are you allotted a certain like 6 months, a year, and then you have to be on your feet and they offer classes or anything? What was that?
No, I didn't have that. You know, the reason why I left, I went from, because I was in like four different shelters in all the boroughs. So the reason why I left is because, you know, there was a lot of women there who were angry and upset and about life. About what's right. happening in their lives, about the direction their life is going in, the father's not there. So I was like basically the only man there in a lot of shelters, the only single man.
Okay.
Some of them had, you know, the father's there with the family, mm-hmm. but I was the only single man there. So a lot of times, if they weren't trying to get in my pants, they were frustrated with me because I was a man. Here's a man. Now, oh, you're one of them kind of. Let me get him. So they would take it out on my children. They'll try to come after my children.
Gotcha.
They'll try to take their. They'll try to get their child to beat up on my kids, and I wasn't having that. So I would get into an argument with them, and you know, being that I was a man, and I was told that, well, you're a man, you should know better, and all that bull crap. They would transfer me out of the shelter and send me to another shelter. So that's why. I have this experience with all the shelters, and I know what I'm talking about. But you know what? Things happen for a reason. You know, because if I didn't go through this, I wouldn't be able to write this book.
Right.
And you know, let people know what's going on in the shelter systems and for fathers to take care of their kids. So you know, I'm kind of happy. You know, I'm kind of happy it happened like that.
Okay.
So now I get to get on radio, find sister-to-sister radio shows like this.
We appreciate that.
Express myself. And, you know, if you've been on my website, you saw I've been a number of cable shows. Cause
right.
People want to hear what I have to say.
Definitely.
And
definitely.
And I have a story to tell. And,
so,
and I just want, you know, I just want more black people to, you know, just to get together and find a solution for ourselves and for our children. You know, we have to, you know, like I said in my book, we have to rehab, and that's the word I use. We have to rehab ourselves because other people don't give two craps about us. They're waiting for us to dry up and blow away. That's what they're waiting for. They're waiting for us to kill each other off, and we can't give them that satisfaction. So we, the men, not the women, because the women are predominantly doing what they're supposed to do. The men, in my opinion, are the problem. The men have to start getting their self together. Once the men start getting their self together and they start becoming more responsible and being a part of their children's lives, then, you know, things are going to start going well for us. You know what I mean? Because the women are struggling by themselves and they can't do it by themselves. And I'm telling you, for an example, they can't do it by themselves most of the time. Because you have a lot of strong women out there who are making it happen, who are sending their kids to college, but it's not the majority. So we need the man to participate and be a part of these children's lives and help the mother out, give the mother a break when she needs a break, because she needs a break sometimes from these children. That's why a lot of them go out and they do things they shouldn't do, talking about the women, because they're overwhelmed with all these children, especially when the boys get a certain age. They can't handle
right.
the boys no more.
They become a handful.
Can't handle the teenage boys no more. They can handle the father, they can handle the daughter, but the boys, that's your enemy, because y'all can't handle them. And y'all give them so much love anyway that it's like, oh, that's my little baby, he's 18 years old, let him go to work.
Right,
you understand
we overcompensate.
What I'm saying? So the boys become difficult to handle. That's when the father should be there.
Hold
you know
that
what
thought
I mean?
One minute, Myra has... Myra, hold on 1 minute, DeNovo. Myra has a question for you.
And actually,
sure.
I agree with what he was saying, that even in villages and tribes, the men would take the boys out for their rites of passage for
right.
them to become men. And I'm a firm believer that we do need men to lead. It doesn't mean that
absolutely.
It doesn't mean that we are weak as a woman or we submissive.
No,
because it actually
no.
means you're actually stronger.
You're strong.
Because you're allowing somebody to reassume the role that they're supposed to have.
And a strong woman is going to support her strong man, and that strong
absolutely.
Man is going to support that strong woman, and
absolutely.
Then you just become strong altogether. I know when I was in marriage counseling, and one thing the pastor did say, he said, you know, was talking to my husband, he said, you have to, I know she may seem pushy sometimes and overprotective of you sometimes, but women have intuition and women sense things that aren't going right. And men at times have to stop dismissing her or dismissing
absolutely.
The woman because we sense things
agreed.
And we see things.
You know, absolutely.
And you would never, now I could do a lot of, last week I said I could do a lot of things without a man, certain things I can do, but I need my strong black man in my life because I can't do everything. Mm-hmm. And so
we need each other, honey.
We need each other. We need each other to rebuild our communities, to rebuild our children. We really do. So I completely support and understand exactly what you're saying. We need.
It's not just rebuilding. It's not just rebuilding, which is true, but we need each other to keep each other in check.
Yes.
You understand?
Yes.
Outside of the children and their needs, their desires, and their wants. Just each other.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? We keep each other in check. We keep each other strong. We need each other. The woman needs us. She has her weaknesses.
Yes.
And the man has his weaknesses. The woman puts the man in check, let him know what he's supposed to be
absolutely.
Doing, what he's not doing. And the man tells the woman what she needs to be doing
absolutely.
And her weaknesses. We need each other. Nobody is more stronger than the other.
And
we need each other and to keep ourselves balanced. And that means a balanced household. That
mm-hmm.
means a balanced community. That means a greater America.
And that's a valid point because we talk about that, and I've talked about it in great detail when we talk about what's needed to restore this village. Okay, that's the whole piece of this restoration of this village. So now let's go, DeNovo. Okay, so you finally get back on your feet, you secure, you know, housing, and you still got your boys. And for some unfortunate reason, you end back
I
up
go
in the
back
shelter
into the shelter system. Correct. I went back into the shelter system because when I got out of the shelter the first time, I went into the Bronx. I got a two-year agreement, a two-year lease with my landlord. That ran out. I didn't want to stay in the Bronx because I was getting into a lot of fights. People were picking on my kids. I had to protect my kids. So I wanted to go to Queens, where I was familiar with. And I had a girlfriend. I had met a girlfriend. And she moved with me. When we got to the apartment in Queens, in time, we broke up. At that time, she was holding down some of the responsibilities of paying the bills. I got stuck with her half, which I wasn't prepared for. I started slipping back in my rent. And I wound up, you know, years later, we're talking about 5-6 years later, after me getting out the first time, I wind up going back into the shelter. Now, my boys were older at that time. So around that time, the mother started getting sick. So I told my oldest son, you have to go stay with your mother. She was sickly off and on. And the boys came back, and then they went back. And it was back and forth with them going to their mothers when they got older. So I went into the shelter with two of my sons. And it was for a shorter period of time. It was for like 2.5 months compared to 2.5 years. So I stayed there for a while, and I was like, you know what? I'm not going to take my sons through this crap again. I'm not. So I talked to them. I asked them what they wanted to do, if they wanted to go stay over to their mothers, which they really didn't want to do. But they didn't want to stay in the shelter again. But the shelter gives you the runaround. And if you don't abide by the rules and regulations, they'll send you back to what they call PATH, and you have to do all that stuff all over again. And it affects the kids' schooling, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It affects their self-esteem, you know what I mean? So I didn't want my boys doing that. Their schooling was doing great. You know, I work with my boys with their schooling and their reading and things like that. I make sure they go to the library, they do their homework, and they read up on their black history, which is another thing I think black people are not doing. which is good for their self-esteem. It's teaching them their history, which is a big mistake we're making. So my boys got together, and it's like, listen, Dad, we want to go stay with Mom. And at that point, I called the mother up, and she was reluctant to take them, but she took them. And I became homeless on the street. That's how that went. I was homeless for about like 6 months. I was working. I still had my job. I wasn't in school at the time. I had to leave school. And I was jumping from one family member to another. Again, I was dressed nicely. I was washing. I had money in my pocket. I just didn't have a roof over my head. And for 6 months, I was, and this was around November when it was cold. So around 6 months, I was sleeping out of my van. I had a van. I was going from my brother's house, my grandmother's house, different houses. And I was very unstable until I wound up getting my apartment again. So I was there back into the shelter for a shorter period of time.
Right.
That book is a little different from Sheltered. Again, is a little different from Sheltered. Sheltered talks about me as a single father raising three boys in the New York City shelter system, which is like a dual story. I talk about the shelter, and I talk about me as a single father raising three babies. So you're hearing, you know, you're getting information in two different areas. Sheltered Again briefly talks about me going back into the shelter. What I do with Sheltered Again is I try to let people know the mindset that they need to have into getting out of the hole that they're in. While I was homeless, I would visit the library often, and I would continue to write Sheltered Again because I knew it would be a good book for my readers, you know, for people who are down and out, who are homeless, who are in negative situations. I taught them to have a positive, and I teach you to have a positive state of mind, to love yourself, talk to God. It's a mental aspect to this book. Don't let people get up in your head and tell you what you can and can't do.
Amen.
Just love yourself. Have that desire you used to have when you was a teenager and younger. You know, this is what I want to be, and I'm going to go after it. And this is what I would teach my readers. Stay positive. Let me remind you, I'm in my 40s now going through this. And I would teach them, stay positive. Go after your goals. You can do it. It don't make no difference how old you are, what your situation is. Just keep talking to God, because you always got to have God in everything that you do, or you ain't just going to get there. If you get there, you're going to fall right on your face without having God. That book is basically about, staying positive, getting out of the shelter, getting off the streets, not allowing people to deter you and tell you who you are and what you aren't and what you can do and what you can't do, and just keep going after your goals, and you're going to reach it. That's what Sheltered Again is about.
I don't know if you are traveling around the United States of America, but I would love if you would come to my school and speak to my students.
I would love to do that. I really
would love if you would come and just speak to some of my young black male students.
Because, I would love to.
Because, you know, because that shelter, and even though it's a physical shelter that you were in, that shelter just applies to life. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of us, we have our own personal shelters that we live in, and we don't grow from it, and we hinder ourselves from it, because your story alone gives me hope, you know. And I work with a group of children who I've never seen who don't have hope. And I'm going to get your information from Tracy, because AKA RAWSILK.
you could, because that is true, and that was one of the reasons why I wanted to talk to him, because just in talking to him, and he and I only got to speak briefly, and our schedules have been crazy. But when you meet him, the positive energy that comes from him is amazing. Because when he walked, I even called him back. I said, "Hey, come here. I want to get you on my show." Okay, and I called him back. And one of the things I want to talk about, since she talked about that, tell us some about Youth World Today.
Youth World Today. Youth World Today is my website. It's is the title of the company that I'm trying to get off the ground. Youth World Today, what I do at Youth World Today is I talk to fathers. I talk to fathers. I'm focused on black men. That's my focus. I have the story, and I have the background, and you have to listen to me. You have to listen to me because I've been through it, and I've overcame it. So my goal is to just get out there and talk to black men, talk to about being fathers and being in their children's lives, and this is the difference that you as a black man can make if you're in your children's lives, male or female. This is the difference that you can make. The mother took it to this level, you can take it through the roof, but you have to be there for them. I talk to young black males as well. I'm doing this right now. I'm a mentor. You go to my website, you'll see everything. It's like a resume. It'll tell you everything that I'm doing and that I've done. I talk to young black males today, and I talk to them about if you staying positive, stay in school, because that's what my boys are doing. My boys are going to college now. They're studying to be the best that they can be.
And I need you to say that again, because that's really, really important or whatever, because so many times we hear about statistics and our people being lost in the system. And at a time in your life that, irregardless if you were working, just to maintain your mental sanity of raising three young boys, maintaining a job, and trying to keep pressing on to be the best father, best parent that you can be is stressful. I know, because I've gone through those stresses as a single mom. So with that being said, and now the testimony is that these young men are in college, is once again another opportunity to say, job well done, brother, job well done.
Well, you know what? I'm really humble, and I appreciate it, and I thank you. And I get that often. But you want to know what? I'm very humble about that, because you want to know why? I'm doing my job. This is what I'm supposed to do. I don't need to be patted on my back for doing something that I'm supposed to do. Yeah. The reason why I'm looking so good to other people, and people want to hear me talk and they want me to come out to the schools or talk to the fathers, is because other men ain't doing their damn jobs. If other men were doing their jobs, you wouldn't even notice me. But because so many fathers are AWOL and their responsibility, it makes me look good. And I'm very humbled about it. But you know what? I can't accept the you're a great father thing, because I'm just doing my job. I'm doing what I'm supposed to do. I shouldn't have to be patted on the back for something that, I'm put on this earth to do.
It's not a pat on the back.
It's just recognition.
Yes.
We need to uplift.
Yeah.
We need to show. And I hear you and I understand, but the thing is, we need to give recognition, because we dang sure give recognition to a bunch of other things that we have no damn business doing.
Exactly.
So I forgive me. That's the one thing I got to disagree with you, sir. I want to uplift, hand my hand out and uplift you and continue to do that, sir.
I appreciate it.
Thank you.
And keep on saying thank you, because yes. One thing is that, number one, is you're already an underappreciated class, number one. That compiled with raising three positive men that are actually going to be contributors to this village is another reason. So I'm sitting here with two school teachers who deal with the aftermath of what could have potentially happened to those three boys. We could potentially be saying that one of my sons is in Rikers Island and the other one is in Elmira and the other one is in Ossing, New York, better known as the penal systems of the greater New York. So the testimony, again, is you continue to be humble because God knows your heart. But by the same token, also accept those praises because you deserve them. I understand what you're saying, because as a single mom, people would often say, oh, you did a job, you well done, and your son speaks very well, and da-da-da-da, and you'd be like, okay, that's not a compliment. That's what I'm supposed to do.
Exactly.
But when you look at the things, okay, the expectations is mothers are doing this across the nation. again, there's fathers that's out there doing it. We just don't hear about them. Some of them don't have a face. We don't see it. You know, one of the things, think about this, DeNovo. One of the greatest commercials that everybody thought was the greatest thing in the world is the commercial where LL Cool J was sitting and he braided his daughter's hair, and it was in them crazy funky braids. And that became a number one commercial, not because anyone, there's not one person sitting here that can remember the product that LL Cool J was selling at the time, because I can't. The one thing that we can remember is look at this dad sitting with his daughter, and even though her braids was crazy, the fact that he took the time to do it was something that we remembered.
Oh, the one with the guy with the little girl is the cheerleader.
Exactly, the cheerleader, yes. You know, and stuff. So those are the things. So before we go on with our conversation, I want to give you an opportunity to shout out some contact information on how people that's listening could get in contact with you, purchase your book, and things of that nature. So can you share that with us?
Oh, please. I'll be more than happy to. My website is called, again, youthworldtoday.com. All right. My phone number is 347. Oh, I'm sorry. 917-530-6136. That's 917-530-6136. And you can, like I said, you can go to my website. I also sell shirts called Holding It Down shirts. What I'm doing with the shirts is I have young black men on a shirt in a cartoon character. And they're holding their babies, or they're pushing their babies in the stroller. And they got their pants down to their butt. They got their hats on backwards. And I just want to show these young men, or show men, that it don't make no difference what your situation is or your status. If you could be a thug or whatever, just take care of your kids. Because that's why we're in the predicament we're in right now. Because we are not taking care of our children the way we're supposed to, and it's killing me. It kills me. And my goal is to get out there, speak for fatherhood, get out there, fathers, do your job. If you do your job, I am an example of what the outcome can be. Your kids will go to college. They'll be respectful to others if you're teaching them that. They'll have table etiquette if you're teaching them that. A man can take a child a long way if he's in that child's life. And that's what I push for. Get out there, do your job, fathers, and I'm going to make that happen.
One of the things that we talked about, DeNovo, on one of the shows is that we wanted our education system to get back to some of the things, and I'm going to tell my age once again, that they used to teach in school, like parenting classes and home economics and things of that nature, and eliminate some of the foolishness that's going on. Because once again, the assumption is that just because a person births a child or donates some sperm to have a child, that does not make you a parent. Not everybody has those skills and knows what it takes.
I'm glad you recognize that at 45. Just want to let you know.
I'm 45.
Yeah.
I love you.
I love you, too.
I love you. My birthday is in 12 days.
Oh, no. Oh, yeah.
45 will not be the number it hits, 45. But I like it.
It'll hit 46.
Look, 45, I love you even more.
You sound like a teenager, girl.
No, I'm telling you.
Look, I love you guys.
Give her a glass of wine. It's over.
My husband begs to differ. Thank you very much. But, no, like we were saying, you know, getting back to those skill sets. Now I just want to hear from a father, okay? Because, you know, over the last couple of weeks, it's just been some crazy stuff going. But last week we talked about in the beginning of the show the situation with the police officer chokeholding the young lady and pitching her across the room. Well, a couple of days ago, did y'all talk about the video?
Yeah, we asked them. That was the first thing we did.
Okay, no. I want to talk about a couple of days ago, a video was posted of a young man, probably like about 16, 17 years old.
Yeah, that's what we talked about.
6 foot years old or whatever. Y'all talked about that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I learned from you. I do pay attention.
Okay, so you paid attention.
I follow. I'm one of those guys that do follow the instructions. I follow instructions. I do as I told.
And I share the story. Now Ashley needs to say something because, like, okay, I'm sorry, y'all talked about this. So me and Ashley, 1 hour, 2 cents.
Okay.
Okay. So let me give you my 2 cents. Let me give you Raw Silk 101. I still be taxing that ass, okay? Okay, he'd have got chopped in the throat. But the first thing that I'm thinking about as a mother, if someone sent me that video and I seen any one of my soul say children cutting the food like that, they would be doing.
Well, like I just told them, my first year, and one parent, I didn't press charges because I felt so bad for her because you could see it in her eyes. She was just like, I'm tired. Her son literally reached out and twisted my nipple. My first, I was a 23-year-old teacher. I just turned 23. He reached out and twisted my nipple.
At this time, I like to thank God for discernment because I wanted to be a teacher. And some kept saying, no, you don't. No, you don't. So I thank you, Jesus.
This is one thing I want the teachers to understand. Maybe you can agree with me. Is that even though we are teachers, we are women first.
Oh, yeah.
We are women first. And when I saw that video with that boy, I had three thoughts. My very first thought was, I bet $1 million that he don't act like that on a normal basis. Right. I think that if you look at that substitute, she was very meek and mild, very humble woman. She did stand her ground. I appreciate that. But that was definitely a woman that you could run over. I don't feel like that child did that regularly. Mm-hmm. That's number one. Number two, however, it would not have occurred to Ashley Jefferson. None of my children ever would have done anything like that because that's just not the energy I put out. But I will let them know I have no problems with pressing charges against them. I have no problems with suing.
So nice. Give me a hug.
I have no problem with suing the school system for not providing me with the proper protection. Because a lot of times when these children come through the system, you know from kindergarten that they have
an issue. They got a chart that lasts you for the rest of your life.
There's a certain, this is what it is. You have to know how to word your reports. And you have to use specific techniques.
And it's called chopping you in the throat. Okay? I am sorry. I am so glad that I am not an educator because I will be underneath the jail. Because the first time you stood, okay, DeNova, walk with me down this walk, okay? You know, coming from New York City, right, we have a perimeter rule, okay? It's part of the streets in New York. You don't come into my perimeter because that's
my
space. Exactly. Once you come into my space, that means you're trying to do me something. And okay, so now I'm forgetting about filling out your reports and calling and doing everything. You get ready to get that behind
that. And that's what I said in your report.
But you would get some money.
You have to. Restrain this. You have the, as an educator, you have the right to restrain and translate as I speak, a right to restrain the student.
Remember how you used to look at a kid and say, "I'm gonna see you at 3 o'clock."
But see,
at 3:15, I'd have been waiting for his behind in the parking lot.
I speak on this because one of my coworkers actually had a very similar situation that happened
terrible.
To her, and she was awarded some money. The situation, I'm just let you all know, she was jumped.
That's not going to happen to me.
By some children at my school. Okay, so she does take a couple of days off. She comes back to school, and then there was some issues. She says, I'm going to tell the school board, I'm going to tell the charter board, blah, blah, blah. She ends up being fired. She gets an attorney. She is awarded a nice sum of cash. My thing is here, at least in my school and in other schools that I know, there is no more in-school suspension. The suspension, the ways to suspend a child, like regular, you have to go through so much red tape to suspend a child, and then now even more to expel a child. So when children are doing or behaving this way and you send them to the principal's office, they will turn right back around and come right back into class. There's absolutely no discipline. And putting a police officer in the class is not really doing a lot.
And that's why in the... See, So when you get control of your classroom, it's by any mean necessary. But when you write it up, you use the proper terms you need to use.
So
to
I'm all down with the proper terms and all that, because that's what people need to learn. But I'm telling you, when your life is on the line, you ain't worried about proper terms and how to say stuff. The child need to be sent out of the classroom and stay out of the classroom.
See, you're not understanding what I'm saying.
Be there.
What I'm saying is, the child that twisted my nipple, mm-hmm. I handled him the appropriate way.
Right. I got you.
To maintain.
I got you.
Yes.
Like, see, I'm
so
with
what
that.
So
I would have handled him the proper way.
So
it would get documented.
How did you handle him?
It got documented.
How did you handle that?
I am currently an educator, and I am speaking on a radio station.
He was handled.
He was handled the appropriate way.
Okay.
But did you hear about the teacher and that this parent beat up a teacher here in the city?
Walked up in the class,
locked
the door and it went off on
him. And yes.
And why?
They think that she is mentally ill, but she went and she assaulted a teacher, and the teacher's in the hospital.
For a while.
So I'm not sure why that happened, but in a situation where the children are attacking you, and I'm not saying what that woman has done is right, but in a situation where a child is attacking you, what are the steps that can be taken to address that situation at that time or to prevent that from happening?
It's a life or death situation.
And that's what I'm saying. It's a life or death situation. And I don't care if I'm a teacher or not.
Throw a desk at me, throw a chair at me, whatever you want to throw at me.
I am a woman first. You will be best that I don't have a shank in my purse.
Would you let them know, first and foremost, it is your constitutional right to defend yourself.
Mm-hmm.
So you defend yourself. But in documenting it,
yes, in the documentation process,
that is correct. Let's go one step further, though. Okay, let's take the young man uh-huh. in this situation, DeNovo, and I want you to chime in. Okay, everything about his behavior dictates, sadly, that either you don't have a man figure that's poured positive stuff into you, or you're just mentally challenged. I think it was a mentally challenged class because it was 10. It was 10, only 10 kids in the classroom.
No, but it was also a substitute in the classroom.
That child in that classroom, he treats his parents like that.
And it's
very clear that's the way he treats his parents. And his parents probably do not do anything but take away a car, take away something that's minuscule from him. But that's
the reason why hold that thought 1 minute, Ashley. So, okay. DeNovo, I'm going to ask you, as someone who raised a child, because the first thing that I said when I seen that young man acting the fool, I said, see, United States government, that's one of those timeout kids. That's one of those kids that got timeout instead of getting their behind taxed. What do you feel about this new wage system, the way we are forced to rear our children?
Oh, the way we're forced to raise our children. I think everything starts at home, for one. All right? We can't, we can't depend on the government or anyone else to raise our children or to try to get us out of this hole that we allow ourselves to be in. As far as the children are concerned, it's in school, everything starts at home. So if the government is not teaching your children how to be the best that they can be, and enforcing and instilling positiveness within that child, it's up to the mother and the father. That's why it's important to have that mother and father figure.
Okay,
because the child is going to listen to their mother and father.
So this is where
go ahead.
This is where I need to jump in. One thing that really does irk me is when parents point the finger at other parents saying they need to learn it at home. That bothers me. Reason why is because I feel like all parents have issues with their children. It's not just one parent. We can't just point the finger at the other parent because that other parent is pointing the finger at you. So here's my truth. And it's as a teacher, we had parent-teacher conference. There was one child, I will not say his name, let's say his name is John. This boy was a royal terror in my school. Okay, he was one of my students. He was a royal terror. On parent-teacher conference day, I did not expect to see his parents because usually those children, they don't have parents that care. But his mother did show up. Soon as she hit the front door, she was met with administration and teacher, one right after another. She had to walk through the school to get to the auditorium where the actual parent-teacher conference was. By the time she got to me, she was angry, she was disgruntled, she was just a mad woman. And in my eyes, she was an angry black woman who don't know how to raise her kid, because at that time she had attitude, okay? I said, hello, I'm Miss Jefferson and I teach your son. She said, I already know you teach my son. She had the attitude of Satan, okay? But the reason why, because I was commenced to tell her about her son, she said, Miss Jefferson, I already know. Because as soon as I walked through the door, I have been stopped by every adult in this building to talk about how difficult and horrible my son is. But what y'all don't know is that I have been with my husband, his father, for over 20 years. What you don't know is that we also live with his grandmother, or she lives with him. So he comes from a three-parent household. What you don't know is that we are in church on Sunday and Friday, and this boy not only sings in the choir, but he is the leader of the usher board. What you don't know is that this boy goes to some sort of school outside of the school that we were in, and he is an A student there. Of course, every teacher in there was shocked. Why? Because he comes from a fantastic home. A fantastic home. But he was a terror. So that makes me think it's not always what's going on in the house. And I get sick and tired of hearing these parents say it's other parents and it's other households. Because I have another example for you. My grandmother had three children by the time she was 19. She had gave birth to my father when she was 14. All of those boys came out successful. Every last one of them. None of them in jail. None of them seen it inside of a jail. Let's fast forward 40 years. I know another young woman who raised two children on her own, for real on her own. None of those children are in prison. None of those children act like a terror. And this woman is working hard. Sometimes it's the children, but I really have to sit here and say a lot of times it is the school system. We have completely taken out discipline from the school system. We did not have in-school suspension. So if a child acts up, they just have to act up right then and there. It is extremely difficult to suspend and expel a student because there's a lot of money involved, and the school wants to keep that money in there. Yeah. So those kids can act ridiculous. The teachers are being abused. And if they do not have control of their classroom, if the kids take control over them, then what happens is the teacher is dismissed because they say that she or he does not have classroom management. But the truth of the matter is, I don't care who you are, if you are in a room, an overcrowded room, and you have 40, I had 35 students in my class, 35 students, one person, it is completely preposterous to think that these children will not overtake you.
That's the thing. Let me add something to that. You know, and I'm coming from classes where I've had 50 and 60 kids, and going to classes with 50 and 60 kids and substitute kids and stuff, a situation. You know, this is where you see two issues. One, you see it in sports. Even if they have a quote-unquote head coach and you got a football team of 55, 56 kids, but you got a bunch of other assistant coaches. But you're willing to pay schools, high schools, college, middle schools, whatever, and pros to handle a bunch of men, young boys, even kids that were younger than the ones that you're going through, and provide coaches, but you can't pay that amount of attention or provide enough as you would do in a classroom. That's one. Two, over the years, over a century now, we've dehumanized, not offered the same type of respect for education in terms of who's offering. And I'm saying that in terms of we still have the stereotypical issue of it's women's work or it's women's job. And I do not believe if we have not did this, okay, first of all, we need more men in schools and they're teaching. I feel that if we have had men, white, black, whatever. And, you know, preferably we'd like to see an even number. But if we have more men in school, the ratio is so ridiculous, I don't even want to give it. And the thing is, if we have more men in schools, more men, besides just being there the coach and being the gym teacher, but don't teach other classes, if we have more men showing there, then men, young women and young boys would see to have respect. Because if you're not teaching, besides the fact that you're a teacher, what y'all mentioned before is that you're women first, that you're not respecting you as a woman, much less your profession as a career as a teacher. But if you're not respecting you as a woman, then what do you expect these kids are going to do? You're not paying them very well, well enough. And then your only benefits that you give them, true benefits, is if you work in the worst of worst, so schools. And then, you know, after 4 or 5 years, if you're alive after the fact, or if you don't come out needing extra mental health counseling yourself for teaching it. So it's like, what, you know, we need to get more men in these schools to help support. Almost as where, you know, this is why we need the social services people in the counselors, the QMHPs and mental health workers, all these different things now, because we let it go to pat.
But it goes back to what Ashley just said. It is the schools, because you have organizations like 100 Black Men that have showed up to the schools and said that we want to work with you and be in the system. DeNovo could tell you, we heard Minister Farrakhan say at the Million Man March that they've actually contacted school administrators to say what we can do to help. Once again, it's like, we got this, number one. Number two is, the thing is that everybody, it is financial. Like she said, nobody wants to cut their piece of the pie. Mm-hmm. Now, again, going back to my age, okay, when I was a kid, your parents volunteered to help in classrooms. My mother used to come to school and help in classrooms. It wasn't unheard of. That was part of the PTA's purpose. The PTA's purpose was bigger than just having fundraisers and pie sales and things of that nature. So again, when we talk about restoring the village, because these things are not happening in those schools, they're happening in our schools. Okay, and again, we have people right now that today is an election day. Okay, and they don't even know who's running for their school board. They don't even know who's running for their board of supervisors. This is not that election. Oh, I thought it was the presidential election. Well, since it's not the presidential election, I'm not going. I ain't got no time for that. These are the things of why we're in the situation that we're in, because someone is asleep at the gate, and those of us that are not asleep, that keep rallying the call, we get persecuted for you either anti some other race or whatever, and we say it time and time again. Being pro-black doesn't mean I'm anti-anything. It just means that I have to take care of this village first and restore this village first. Then we can look at some of our other brothers and sisters that are probably 15 steps ahead of us, okay? Our children's blood is running in the street, like Doc says, and until we start getting some reform and putting people into positions of power that are going to focus on our children, I said it last week, I'll say it again, we keep talking about this next generation. There is not going to be a next generation unless we grasp a hold of this thing and turn it around quickly. And DeNovo raised a valid point when he says, fathers, you need to do your job. You need to be accountable. You may not want to be with me anymore, but that doesn't alleviate you from your responsibility of these children. Mothers, you don't get to walk away. This is not a doll. One of the things that we used to teach children or whatever, oh, you want a baby? Let me show you what it takes to have a baby. It is sad that in order for this young man on the phone to realize about Pampers and how to change them and all of that, he had to go through a crisis to get to that point. These are things that were taught in school, and people poured those things into them, and guys took economics and sewing and all of those other things that's deemed as womanly things, because you never know. You know, the testimony, DeNovo, could have been where, unfortunately, mom didn't have to walk away, she could have passed away. You see what I'm saying? There's some man out there that's right now, like, think about the man who wife died during childbirth. Yes. And now he has this angel in his hand going, what shall I do with this babe? Because he don't know. He don't know.
Yeah, but see, everything, I agree with what everybody's saying, you know what I mean? But see, we have so many issues that is overwhelming our community. We don't even know which way to start at. You know, we're blaming the teachers, we're blaming the government. And again, you know, even though some of you might disagree with me, I'm sold on the fact that it starts at home. It starts with the mother. It starts with the father. That's why it's imperative for the father to be there.
It starts
at home. We're grasping at straws. We're pointing fingers at other races, at other people. And it all starts at home. It all starts with us. It all starts with us going back and raising our kids as a community. That's what we were doing well back then in the 50s and 60s.
Exactly.
Because we raised them as a community. And we fell off on that. We fell away from that. I'm not going to get into, but it all starts at home. Trickles down to the teachers and to the government and all that stuff. But if we don't come to grips with it starts at home and we're looking elsewhere, we're never going to remedy our problems, and our children are going to continue to pour blood in the streets, and cops are going to continue to kill them. We are looking at different places, and it all starts at home, and that's the spark. Then it trickles down to other parts of society.
I agree, and before I go to Ashley, I agree with you wholeheartedly. I think it does start at home. It takes these conversations. I agree with you because I grew up, and you know how in New York City, it's a village of people that looks out for you, your children. Okay, most of us was latchkey kids. So we need to get back to that village mentality or whatever and stop blaming everybody else for our shortcomings and start looking at the man in the mirror. But we also need to start saying that if you're not going to educate my child the way my child is going to be educated, then I will make sure that he gets educated. I will do it myself. And if that means that I have to homeschool, if that means I have to remove my child, if that means I've got to get my behind up 2 hours early to drive my child across town to school, do whatever we got to do. That's what's missing. We're living in this society now where we're not fighting for our children. You know, I had an argument, a debate, so to speak, with somebody on Facebook a couple of days ago that said, you're really up in arms about this girl being pitched across the room. It ain't even your kid. She is my daughter. Mm-hmm. She's all of our daughters.
But okay,
why do we always have to wait until something affects us personally
and then
before
you wanna cry,
get involved?
And then you want to sit there and cry, oh, please someone say something. But then it's like, oh, don't snitch, don't talk, don't do this.
Exactly.
Until it happens to your child. And then now you want to cry the blues.
Okay. Police brutality is not an issue until it happens to you or somebody in your family. Our children being assaulted in school doesn't happen until it happens to you or your family. Okay. Time and time again or whatever and stuff. And the problem, I think it goes even much deeper than that, is that, again, until we sit at the table and recognize that there are systems in place that did not include us, that did not even consider us as human beings of worth, we're not going to move any further. The problem is that people do not want to discuss racism. People do not want to discuss about the systems that have still been designed to keep us back. People don't want to talk about that the school systems are absolutely terrible, that teachers are underappreciated and drastically underpaid, that the classrooms are overcrowded, okay, that the children, your behind should not be still sitting in school at 18 and 19 years old, okay? If you are 18 and 19 years old, there should be a program that you can go to that if you desire to go to school, if you have those extra challenges on you and you need assistance, then we got you. But if your behind is being sent there for free babysitting service for somebody else to deal with your mess while you go to work, that's not acceptable.
Here's what I wanted to add. I agree with everything that is, girl, you are speaking the gospel truth right now, one step away from Jesus, because everything you're saying is true. The only thing that I want to say, not even in reference to what you were saying, but to saying that it starts at home, I 100% agree that it starts at home. But when you go to a place where your normal is different, you will behave like the different version of normal.
I agree with that.
And so when you, even if you are an angel in your house, when you know that these rules shall not be broken here, when you go to school and you see there's a different standard of acceptance, you will follow that standard.
And that's what and I see with those girls exactly. in a classroom when they were videotaping and they were laughing.
Exactly.
They didn't want to be on camera because they were smart enough to go, my mama might see this.
And she, and that is why I really do not believe that that tall grown boy is special ed. I don't believe that he has a bad home. I bet you both his parents might be at home. But there is a standard in school that is so low that he only has to rise to this level to make it.
Now,
that is what personally I believe. I don't know these children, but just for me watching that video and seeing how that
you can see the demographics of it. What it was.
I don't think that was a special ed class. I think that it was a regular class. I think that those children have those. Students probably walked out because they saw it was a substitute.
That's
a good
point. I
believe that substitute probably got picked on often. That boy was showing off for those girls. Those girls, much of them did not want to be on camera.
Nope.
I did see some of them come to her defense in a joking way because it was all a joke. Mm-hmm. I don't think that he ever was going to really hit that woman with that.
But you just want
but
it was
however,
intimidation.
It was intimidation. The throwing the peanuts, all of those things, all of it is wrong. I am not saying that he is right. What I am saying is that everybody's child is wrong. You cannot tell me it's not my child, because yes, it is. I don't care who you are. I don't care what your job is. I don't care if you were a senator. I don't care if you was a trash man.
It's
everybody's child. And that is what kills me, because I see these middle class, upper middle class, and sometimes just straight out wealthy parents pointing a finger at a parent that don't have
nothing.
And
like
I'm
don't
sorry,
matter.
It's not everybody.
Exactly.
It ain't just the poor kids.
No, I agree with everybody.
I agree with
it's
you.
A lot of them, because they sitting there, the ones that got the money, and then they sitting there, and what they doing? They're in these clinics every other day getting medication because their kids with Miss Crystal Meth and all this other stuff. And when you mentioned about setting the bar low, I got chewed out by the pound. I don't know if you remember this, Miss Tracy,
And that was not a low-income classroom.
No.
I'm just looking at when I saw that video and I saw the material. I'm sorry, I was so heated about this. I will relax.
No.
But when I
help
saw
yourself.
That classroom, I saw the equipment that classroom had.
It's a charter school.
Exactly. That is a. Oh my God.
Or they got funds. What makes me mad is
she's like fix it, Jesus.
You know, remember when Jay Z put out this thing about you can go and get scholarship for 2.0. I made a big. To do about it. And I was told how wrong I was and this, that, and the other. But I said, what does that take to say that to the other kids who are doing what they can and who are struggling and things of that nature? I'm not saying that someone else don't have. If you got through high school 2.0, there's schools and things for you and things that you can still go to college. And like, to be perfectly honest, let's keep it real. If you want to go to college, go to school, if you don't got the grades, you can go to a college. In New York City, there's tons of, and I'm not just
it's
saying
multiple.
There, but there's you got 50 billion colleges there, D.C., if not even college, training academies, certification programs, whatever the case may be. Heck, if you don't got the money, just come, and then we'll take $10 off your damn paycheck. I mean, you got what, you have something. So there's no excuse. But when you sit there and saying, I'm busting my tail for an A, and then Jay-Z said, I'm just going to give you $5,000 because you got a 2.0, that pisses me off.
2.0.
Exactly. That's just showing up. That is literally showing up. And then now, so I think they give you a 1.8 and showing them, you just got to do something to get to 2.0. Heck, they just give it to you because they want the money in the school. So now I got chewed out saying that I'm wrong, but I'm saying you sit in the bar low. What does it take for all those other kids who are busting their tail and then like, I'll get an A, struggling. I can't still don't get money for school, but then this kid who just don't do nothing is lackadaisical. And then got 2.0, I'm going to get $10,000 because I rep Jay-Z.
And is that the only requirement?
Yes.
The only requirement
yes.
is to get a
2.0.
And how do they even know about you?
Oh, you just fill it out, show that you got 2.0, and then you get it on there.
And he gives anybody money?
Yeah.
Okay, so then anybody who got a 4.0 can fill out the same application and get the same.
No,
money.
But the point.
It's supposed to be a motivating factor to get. If the whole program is jacked backwards because it tells the person who's got a 4.0, you're already excelling, so we're not looking at you.
Not understanding how much I'm busting my tail.
Right, we want you to just get a 2.0 when the average college, you can't go anywhere because you got to have for even a community college, a 2.5, okay? One of the things I want to talk about before we wind up is something that hit the news today, and it was of the father who cut off the head of his ex because he found out that the 6 children that she's been claiming weren't his, and that she had been going, we talked about this earlier, going to his place of employment, embarrassing him, got him fired for one job, back and forth in the child support system, just took this man through hell, and he snapped.
First of all, how did you get that far with 6 kids and not know that did not? I mean, like, before, usually the requirement is you get a DNA test.
No, you don't.
No, I'm saying it's, you didn't even finish. In some places before child support, not all, but in some. So my thing is this: if you, what's going on? I'm not trying to make a joke of the situation, but what's going on after the 1, 2, 3? And you didn't see that stuff was going on, but you're still having kids by this person over these years, and you're going through all this trouble, and then now at the same time. So if you got 6 kids, you want the problem.
So here, that can be very true, to be honest about that. That I agree with that. But my second thought is, this is clearly a dysfunctional situation.
Totally.
Mental health on both sides.
Both sides. And when I first heard the story, I honestly did not even think it was a real story. I thought this was something from The Onion. But, okay, we found out that it is a real story. My thing is, murder is wrong, but the way and the type of murder that is done does raise a lot of red flags. And I'm going to tell you, I believe that everybody has some sort of breaking point where they will snap. But the usual person who gets to that point, which is very far, may grab a knife, may grab a gun. But this person went and grabbed something that was sharp enough to chop a head off. That means that this person is very sick. That you think that way. I would never think.
Well, I can tell you that for one thing, is we are looking at a cultural situation because the gentleman was Rastafarian.
Yeah.
Okay. And so we are clear, anyone that knows the Rastafari culture, for him to cut off his dreads
was a
sacrifice.
And that was what he did
first. He did that first. Yeah. So he knew he didn't want to disrespect his culture, so he cut off his dreads. And he told people what he was about to do. But one of the reasons why I picked that story to wrap up with is because when we talk about, once again, we talk about a biased system. Before you came in, Ashley, that automatic, every time this woman went to court, she was granted child support. Mm. No one ever took a DNA test, which is like almost like you said, Mr. LP, literally unheard of, that, you know, the assumption was because she was his wife, these are your children, and you're responsible for them. And now he snapped. And now the argument in the vast world of social media is there's people that feel like he should not be charged. And then there's people that feel like throw him up underneath the jail. What's the happy medium?
Well, murder is murder. It's wrong. Okay? You was there wrong. My thing is, a type of person that is going to chop your head off has displayed signs of mental instability long before
the second or third child
was even born. I'm just saying, this woman, and I am not blaming the victim. I will not blame the victim, but I will say that this man most definitely has displayed some sort of mental instability at least after the first child, after the second, after the third child. So for you to continuously
assume that she was a gambler, one child, but she had 6
children, that's what I'm, something is off. Something is off.
Wow.
And I cannot put it past her to have been stable either.
Someone's saying this is false. I don't know.
Now, my husband is snoring in the background. Y'all know I got to get ready to take man home. He just got off from work. So, DeNorvo, if you would give us your contact information once again, first and foremost, it has been our pleasure and our honor to have you give us a call in. We've enjoyed dialoguing with you. I've asked everybody to go out there and get the book sheltered and sheltered again. I've already given your number to two people who are interested in having you come speak. And when we have our town hall meeting down here, I hope you definitely come down and talk and share with the brothers and some of the sisters
too. I would more than be happy. So where are you guys located?
We're in Richmond, Virginia. We're 6 hours Virginia. Away from you.
Richmond, Virginia. I love it.
Yes. We are six hours away.
Yeah, I would be more than happy to come there and talk. This is my life. You know what I mean? Getting out there. You know, I presently work in a hospital. I'm a cook's help. And that's something I really wanted to do. I got stuck there because I got custody of my sons. And I had to raise them, and I had to leave school. And, you know, I thought I was going to be there for 5 years, and it wound up turning into 26 years. So, I mean, I've been, you know, that's not what I want to do. This is what I want to do. I want to get out there. I want to make a difference in our communities. Talk to the fathers. Talk to the males. Like I said specifically, I want to get toward talking to men because I believe in order for us to have a strong community, we need to have strong men. Once we have strong men, we're going to be on the up and up. We're definitely going to be going in the right direction. So through my experience and my testimony, I know that I can make a difference in the heads and the minds of these fathers and young kids. Okay. So I'll be more than happy to come out and go
and
anywhere
tell us
in
how
America.
We can contact you once again.
My number is 917-530-6136. To call me if anybody wants me to come in any part of America, if I'm able to get there and talk to our children, I'll be more than happy to do it.
And again, we encourage you. We thank you. We thank you for sharing your testimony, because I don't say story. We thank you for sharing your testimony and encouraging somebody that's out there that's listening. Once again, you've been listening to the Enliven Radio Show, part of the Legacy Internet Radio Group. This is your girl, RAWSILK, sitting in with Miss Ashley. We thank Miss Myra for coming by. And Mr. LP, you got some closing words? We've just untied him today. We let him talk.
Yes. Oh, yes, I got a few words. Thank you very kindly, sir, and everything. I appreciate you very much.
And you have a good night.
And I appreciate you. I think what you people are doing as far as having your shows, your cable shows, or your TV shows and the radio and trying to make a difference in our community. We need more brothers and sisters doing what you people are doing. And God bless y'all. Keep doing it. And I'm sure you're making a difference. And you inspire me.
Well, we definitely will speak again. And we thank you. You have a good evening.
Thank you very much. And any of you teachers need me, just give me a call.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
I appreciate that, gentleman, for coming calling in. Excuse me, not coming by, but at everything. I thank all of y'all for showing up at things. I wanted to say a situation here, and it's a small rant, but ask that everybody listening in present party to please forgive me and give me a minute and things. I'm terribly disappointed with different things, and I'm tired of people always saying that, Stephen, you're on the soapbox. Stephen, you don't get it. You don't understand. You don't live this life. People don't understand. I have in a lot of situations, whether I live that life or not, that doesn't mean you have to change. You can't change. Cutting Edge, Ron Bryan, put a cartoon out the other day about a woman walking through the ghetto in the hood that she, you know, she may be from it, but that doesn't mean it's in her. And that was the same thing I tell people a lot in me, that why, you know, so I did not make that life, and I made a choice within me that I did not want this life and things of that nature, and I'm from this area. Now, that didn't, yes, I try to get away from it, but that doesn't mean I'm not there to try and improve and help everybody else, because it is not supposed to be what it is. And I'm just disturbed. This past weekend, one of my best friends in the world, who's been there, who does everything and what have you, who put her name, and I say this, and I don't need to, I should not have to quantify it, but I say that because she's a white female, who put her name on the line so many times in her life, in her family, to save my life and protect me and things of that nature. She was attacked this past weekend. And over because of a man can't accept rejection, can't accept the fact that, and then felt he needed to boast himself and talk bad about it and all this other stuff. She gets out the car and tries to get away and protect herself. And then all of these different things. Another friend of mine is where people took her money, her child support tax. So she was taking her money to keep her home for her children and things. And at this rate where we see so many problems of families, minority families not getting anything. And she's a Hispanic woman, but not being able to keep a home, and you just raping her for the last bit of the money, and then decides to still go ahead and file the judgment, even though to kick her out, even though you agreed to let her stay there if she was getting the money. And you take advantage of people like that. And it's just like, you know, we just recently had this Tyshawn Lee in Chicago was shot. Was murdered, gunned down, destroyed over, you couldn't find the person you want, so y'all take a hit out on a 9-year-old kid. So I'm saying, oh, he just happened to be the wrong place. No, you do not get 4 or 5 shots in the head and another 5 or 6 in the chest like that. They had the dumbness to go online and post this stuff and saying that, yes, we went after him. You know, we have kids going wild and out in school. And then, you know, we had the Howard University Middle School teachers being fired because they taught a little bit of Black history, which for the correct thing is part of American history. You know, we're willing to teach revolutions and all this other little stuff and things that at this present moment not affecting the day and age of the issues here. Okay, but we were darn sure going to talk about Aristotle. Don't get me wrong, I love Roman history and all this other stuff, but we still can't teach African-American history. We're willing to tell the stupid lie that, you know, Latin American people just decided to give. We couldn't take care of the land, so we gave Texas and Louisiana to the United States. Bull crap and things that you didn't see how you enslaved the Black and Brown for that mess and things of that nature. We have out there in the Midwest a mayor's husband and a group decided to dress up as KKK for Halloween and decided to nearly burn down a cross. But you're saying it was a hoax and then things of that nature. But you still, that is not a crime, which I don't get it. We have in South Carolina, a sheriff decides to wear blackface and dress herself up as Bob Marley smoking weed and things of that nature. Is this crazy? We need to remove we had this Native American outfits out there and things over the Halloween, calling it an outfit and costume, when these are traditional everyday clothing for people, and build and dress them as the Indian hottie or the savage Indian and give them a toy axe. You know, we talk about the gay agenda and people fussing in the Black community. We're tired of seeing gay pushed on TV and things of that nature. And let me say this for the record. I'm not gay or what have you. But I look at it this way. If we could sit up there and fight to try to have our Black Lives Matter agenda to get out there to get recognized, they should have it too or whatever else. As long as it's not out there trying to hurt somebody else, you have a right too. Whether you agree with it or not, but they have a right. And so we can't keep going out there. We are built kings and queens. We have the glow. We have the touch. We have the force. We have the kryptonite. We are promised our milk and honey if we do right by others and things like that. But there's no reason why we should have the ignorance, to utilize ignorance to take it away from ourselves. It's no more of somebody else. We're doing it to ourselves. And those who are still fighting and things, we're allowing others to do it because we say, oh, just don't worry about it. We got this issue now that Obama wants to ban the box, but I thank you for that, but that don't mean a hill of beans to me, because it's still at the end of the day, they want to do the background credit checks and everything else and still don't let you get anywhere. So what the hell that's going to be do? This stance of going to the prisons, okay, you went to the prisons and talked to them. Okay, cool. You didn't tackle the real issues. You didn't talk about the fact that after the prison, what are they doing for their books to try to help them? Or when they come out, they don't have any resources. Now, you signed this bill to release all these low crime people all throughout the states, throughout the United States, but they have no homes. You know, what's the harm? I said it, this should be a law. If you spend more than like 3 months in jail or prison, you should be given a suit and some shoes and a tie or something like that. It should be a law. You know, suit stores should be making money because it gives something, it gives somebody a chance. I'll take a person with a dirty T-shirt who's sitting there trying and coming in for a job and try versus someone comes in a suit with an attitude and things. If we build all these different things, but we still do not have buses to go to jobs and things. We still do not have higher speed railways and things of that nature. We got people willing to give out money for all the dumbness out there. I'll give an example. We have this whole complaint about TLC not making an album. We done gave them nearly $500,000. Bull. And something else afterwards. Because, you know, if you have understanding of business, it takes a while with contracts and legalities, permissions, all these other different things to come up with an album. Just because you're so used to this microwave society that you take your cell phone and a couple of software on your beats and I can make a doggone mix album, yeah, and I release it and sell it out of trunks. If you're trying to do out something quality, it's not necessarily that easy. Not demeaning anybody that made it from that way, but it's not that simple. But then you want to complain about something about people who are already established, not saying that they have not been through some troubles. But then we go through, look at CNN Heroes, and we have a black woman who's spending all her money and everything else trying to feed homeless people. We have an African-American guy out in India and in black areas throughout Africa trying to collect rainforests. We have somebody in South Carolina teaching poor kids and families and low income how to grow foods and things like that and use what we can since the state won't give them any money to grow food. We can't give them money. We have children who need prosthesis. We have children who need surgery, but when they're struggling, I'm seeing 500 out of a thousands of this, that, and the other. But we have people lined up to get Lamar Odom. You know, no disrespect to his illness right now, because I'm not discrediting mental health, drug addiction, and all this other stuff. But we have a guy who lost something, all these different things, but he's still okay. And things, but now he's going to get a book deal in reality, whatever the case may be, once he recovers. But the next person don't. So the guy down the street who can use that kidney that you're willing so freely to give, just because he don't have $10,000 to give you, come on. You know, we need to do better. You know, we do not need to keep searching and questioning who's the next leaders when we all leaders within our own selves. And things, we have the African Film Festivals here in Richmond. And that is about to come up, and then all throughout the country, and film festivals throughout the United States, where we have leaders and people speaking and trying to get out there, but we're not willing to do it. But the biggest films out there is straight out of Compton and some other stuff and things. But we said we want more diversity, more to educate us, but we won't spend our dollar for the same thing that happened to Selma or other educational films out there. We have people that are needing bone marrow. Our Asian American and Native American and Black Americans is fighting mental health. And we think it's just us? No. We have our Asian American and those who are mixed with Asian American and Hispanic. The suicide rates for our children is jumping off the roof. Because they are mixed. They're saying, oh, you're supposed to do this, you're supposed to do that. Oh, and then they're jumping off because neither side of the family can accept each other. Just because two people decide to love each other. We are built to win at all costs. Now, yes, as a human race, we have the ability to adapt, but sometimes we're not supposed to be adapting. Why should adapt something that was promised to us by the good man upstairs? I'm sorry. You know, we cannot stand for the ignorance. A lady saw a quote from Anne Rice. Give me a man or woman who has read 1,000 books and you give me an interesting companion. Give me a man or woman who has read perhaps 3 and you may give me a very dangerous enemy indeed. And things. What are you going to do? We have to communicate, have mercy, check on each other. Stop this thing with whatever, it's not my business. No, like we said, this is all our children. No, this is not my child. Yes, this is our child. We need to start checking each other. We have to fix our mental DNA. Clean out our souls for hate, prejudice, cynical thoughts. Fill our hearts with more hopes and dreams again. And I'm not going to point to one group and organization. There's a blame to go around. I'm not perfect, and neither one anyone else in this world. But there's plenty. I'm going to give one group, and I'm putting in charge of churches, regardless of your denominations of faith. Because All of you need to get your butt in gear. And I got some words for you for some of these old churches, these small churches.
You kidding when he said he had a rant.
Oh yeah. No, I'm sorry. These old churches, whether you're big or small, that don't want to accept technology and don't want to get on these other people and things like that, screw you, shut down, and get the hell out.
What? Did that just come?
Pastor?
What?
Yeah, yes,
did that just come from
yes,
her?
Yes, I say that because all you're doing, because all you're doing is stopping progress. You're not involved in the voting. You're not helping people coming out of jail. I can tell you from personal experience, I went to 10 to 15 doggone people, churches, denominations, faith, and they sit there and turn you down and say, but you were willing to go to there to show faith. Stop, you and these doggone pastors, whether you're big or small, stop trying to be famous. And those ones who are famous, stop trying to be famous and fix your damn communities.
Would you like a hug?
Almost. give me
the one finger.
Give me 2 more minutes. Give me 2 more minutes. And everything else. You know, stop. You know, stop trying to be famous. Start fixing your communities.
Yeah. He took them all week to write this.
No, actually, it was only 5 minutes. Okay. But you know. Stop, get, you know, work, you know, why are we having parents and struggling out there, single mothers or those with families? You know, the church is supposed to be there. If you don't have money for daycare, fix it. You know, nobody should be hungry. Everybody should be able to go there, get food, and not be demeaned if you get needed. You know, no homelessness. Everybody need to have clothes, have washing machines and things out there so people can wash. If I got to go to an interview tomorrow and I'm struggling and things like that, I should be able to go to the church that day before. I need some help, wash my clothes, and keep on going. You know, and then if you start doing doggone things, then you might be.
He is actually waving the finger.
Not at you. Not at you. Sorry.
Yes, he's going in.
But you know, then you might be famous again. Then I'm willing to give you some money.
You're not going to like bomb any place tonight or something,
no.
Okay? Because look, he sound like a man. Like no. I was just like, okay, wait a minute.
I'm like, you about to cut off your dreads?
You know,
like, I'm getting ready to leave the studio.
I'm about to shave the size of my hair.
And we humbly apologize.
I just want to let everybody know.
Normally, fans, we normally tie him up, but we let him go. And
I warned you.
This is what you have had to say for each and every show.
No, that's a bigger list.
We are tying him up next week.
But you know, being intelligent is not dumb. And stop getting on me and everybody else for that. You know, I am not less of a man because I don't have a child.
I had an applause thing to go.
Thank you. You know, we can send all these people and money, and we're talking about troops going over there. You know what? I want to see troops come into the United States and stay in the United States. And you know what? Flush out the gangs. Flush out the KKK. Why are they in existence?
They are getting ready to go down because Anonymous said so.
I mean, it's just like, you know, you have 448 KKK groups registered in the United States, allowed to use my damn tax dollars and your tax dollars to help the meeting, but let me come up in there and hold an education program, please, and you tell me no.
Mr.
I am
LP
not.
Said so.
Amen. I am not going, listen, I am not going to, and this is my
Security.
Final sentence. This is my final sentence.
Hold on, let him get this out.
This is my final sentence. I am not going to stop. I am not asking. I'm not telling you. I am demanding you to stand up and respect yourself and your family. And if you don't want to help yourself, help your community, and get your education going and do something else, then get the hell out.
Tell them, Steve.
Go to Australia, do something else, jump off the river.
Don't go to Australia. I'm going to Australia.
I'm not Australia. I'm sorry. Antarctica. Go there, stay there, lock a cage, and get the hell out, and let the people about progress do something.
Whoa, Steve, calm down, man.
Now, I just want to say that I do not
station
condone
disclaimer.
Any action that
right,
he does
exactly.
After this.
Listen, wait, let me do the station disclaimer. The opinions of this announcer doesn't necessarily express the views of Enliven Radio or the Legacy Internet Radio Group.
All those that are coming on the show.
All those that are guests of the show. Once again, the views of Mr. LP does not represent the esteemed panel here or Enliven Radio or the Legacy Internet Radio Group. Do not send this tape to our job so we can be fired. But we're just going to say Mr. LP said so.
I'm just mad.
Look, look,
I'm
wait. Mad. You ready for it, Steve? Boom.
I'm just mad. And I'm just, you know, I'm trying to, and the really hard part about this is that I'm trying not to bring my evil self in this in the same like you shall all die. I will hunt you down and you will perish. I'm trying not to do that because okay. It just makes me
good
mad.
Night everybody.
I'm sorry.
We're walking out together to make sure. Okay. There's no knives around.
I'm sorry to the general public, but I just want us to do better.
Well,
thank
we are
you.
Glad you got that off of your chest.
I don't know what you was drinking.
Can you play a music selection? Can the people get a going out song?
Yes, I will play a going out song. But before we do, Ms. Jefferson, you do have a business, don't you?
Yes, tell us, Ashley, please.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Everybody, come on down to Kareen Hair and Beauty at 20 North 20th Street, Suite B in Chaco Bottom. We do have our brand new runway collection. This is hair that is direct, believe it or not, from Mongolia. It is very strong, durable hair. It is perfect for styling and coloring and cutting, yet still affordable enough to toss when you want to move on to the next style. So just come on down to Kareen Hair and Beauty, or you can visit us on the web at kareenhairandbeauty.com. If you have any questions, just give us a call, 804-814-9262.
Say the number again.
804-814-9262.
And how do you spell the website?
Corinne is Corine, hairandbeauty.com.
All right. I thank you very much. And go ahead, sir.
And she got nothing to do with Steve.
I don't have nothing to do with that.
Sorry.
You know how they say, I ain't saying nothing. Right. After that, I just thank you once again all for listening. This is your girl, RAWSILK, saying good night.
Good night, everybody.